Is that river black for you? Only mini Omar, is it black for you? People don't know that Niger means nigger. Nigger in Latin, Niger in English, Niger in French. There are Nigerians, my foot. Baboons and monkeys everywhere. And this region, black people are useless. Very, very, they cannot listen very well. Nigerians means people who occupy an area that a river is flowing through, the Black River. Niger means nigger, black. Niger is English word for nigger. Nigger is Latin. Niger is French. It means black, hopeless and useless. And heaven knows we are. This OG, oh dear me. Very, very useless, I tell you. Black people, hopeless. Answering the name a white man gave to a river. You should be ashamed of all yourselves, all of you. Look at yourself in the river. We are here to ensure that the death of 3.5 million people is not forgotten.
This is where we have found the enemy. We have unbelievers. And the effort is rising.
The reason why we exist is to ensure that their memory, that they can never be forgotten, that their memory will linger on forever. As long as man walks this earth, his face will never be killed. Men and women that did nothing, children that were innocent, their only crime is to be blessed by God. That is the only thing they have committed. Through war, everybody looked on and did nothing. Instead of them to help us, they were sure that the land and sea was absolute, that we may die, that the children of God may die. Yet no one is going to have them understanding that we cannot die, that we cannot die.
This is where we have found the enemy. We have unbelievers. And the effort is rising.
Our Father who art in heaven, we are in that your name may be hallowed by men, that we may bow at the mention of it, that we may.
Good morning, dear friends, wonderful people, loving people, peaceful people, and the ancient people themselves. Wherever you may be hearing my voice from, or wherever you are listening from, Biafrans all around the world, friends of Biafrans, lovers of freedom, it is a very, very wonderful morning. From me, from here, to each and every one of us. Today is a wonderful day once again, Almighty Chukwuki Kabiama has made. Today is a wonderful day that Almighty Chukwuki Kabiama has allowed us to be among the living. Today is another wonderful day that Chukwuki Kabiama has given us the gift of life to be among the living. I say to us, Biafrans, wherever you may be, wherever you are, like our leader will say, wherever you are domiciled, this morning I say, a wonderful morning, and the life that Almighty, the gift that He has given to you, make sure that it counts in all you do. Once more, once again, Biafrans, it is a very, very wonderful morning for me, from here, to each and every one of us. Of course, we can see how the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom is descending to their doom. We can see how they are nosediving. We can see how they are crumbling before their own very eyes. We can see how they are buckling. Things keep happening. Things keep on happening in that zoological republic of animal kingdom. Every day, every now and then, things keep happening. News keep on breaking because they are holding their friends. Things that happens to them, they don't even know how it's happening, how it is happening. Things that is happening to them, they don't know how it is happening to them. But they will never learn their lesson. They keep on holding Biafra. They keep on holding our leader. And Almighty Chukwuka Abiamah will destroy that zoological republic of animal kingdom. Chukwuka Abiamah will destroy it because they are holding the children of God. They are holding Biafrans. They don't want to let us go. They keep killing us. They keep imprisoning us. They keep destroying our youths, our young boys, our young men. They are also raping our girls, doing all kinds of atrocity in our land. That is the reason why Almighty Chukwuka Abiamah is going to destroy them. That is the reason why Almighty Chukwuka Abiamah will disintegrate the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom, which they call Nigeria. It is a prayer. And I say, you say to it. Once again, Biafrans, wherever you may be, wherever you're hearing my voice from, wherever you are listening from, or you are just joining, it is a wonderful morning from me, from here, to each and every one of us. Where I am coming out from, the sun has risen. So also it is in Biafra land, in motherland, the sun has risen. And I say, as it is that the sun has risen, when it is time for the sun to rise, the sun will rise. No man can do anything about it. No man can stop the sun from rising. So I also say that Biafra will rise, that no man can do anything about it. No Fulani man can do anything about it. No one Nigerianist can do anything about it. All those that are hiding behind their masters, they cannot do anything about it. And I say this morning, once more, you say, once again, dear friends, it is a wonderful morning from me, from here, to each and every one of us. Of course, you all know that this is Radio Biafra Middle East. And I am coming out this morning, no other place but from the Holy Land of Israel. Tel Aviv is where I'm coming out from this morning, reaching mankind around the whole world. And behind the microphone this morning, it's your son. Behind the microphone, it's your boy. Behind the microphone, it's your brother, one and only, Mazi Uchenna Obilo. And I am here this morning. I am here this morning to do the needful. I am here this morning to preach the gospel of Chukwuka Abiamah according to the restoration of Biafra. I am here this morning to do it like we do it. Once again, I say to us, Biafrans all around the world, a wonderful morning from me, a wonderful morning from here, a wonderful morning to Biafrans all around the world. Bear it in mind that some of us now may be their knights, some of us now may be their evening, and to some of us now may be your afternoon, and to some of us now may be your morning. As it is here where I'm coming up from, I say to us, each and every one of us, according to my own time, according to my own time here where I'm coming up from, it is a very, very wonderful morning to each and every one of us, dear friends all around the world, this morning. And this morning, we will go into it this morning to preach the gospel of Chukwuka Abiama according to the restoration of dear friends. All right, this morning, dear friends, they keep on holding us. They keep on holding us. They don't want to let us go. But Chukwuka Abiama is going to destroy them all. The Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom says they kidnap our leader. They put our leader in the dungeon. Of course, we all know that our leader was kidnapped. Not from the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. And you all must know that our leader is not a Nigerian. He was kidnapped, which is known to be extraordinary rendition. And if you want to go find that out, you will be amazed to understand what the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom has done. It is a mistake they will keep on making. It is a mistake that will swallow the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom up. As I tell you, the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom is gone. As I speak to you, Nigeria is gone. Even some of their governors, they are testifying to it. They are testifying to it. When we tell you that Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom is a government of terrorists, when we tell you that government of the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom, they are terrorists. They have nothing in their head. They don't care about you. They don't want to take care of you. They don't want you to live a good life. Some of us do not understand it. When we tell you that Nigerian government is a government of death, some of us do not understand it. It's a breaking news. I'm trying to find it so that I can bring it to us. A breaking news that, all right, I'm trying to look for it. That a terrorist has hit somewhere in the north. I think it is Sokoto, but I'm not sure. But I'm trying to find it so that I can bring it to us. That is exactly what you have in the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. Because they are the government of terrorists. The terrorists will keep on chasing them. Terrorists will keep on destroying them. Terrorists will keep on doing whatever they wish to them because they are the sponsor of the terrorists. But now they don't have the power to control them anymore. Nigerian government is a government of death, you must know that. They have been killing ordinary people in that contraption called Nigeria. They have been killing the indigenous people in that contraption just to pave way for them to go to the Atlantic Ocean and dig their Quran, as their forefathers said to them. And they say it is a task that must be accomplished to kill those infidels, to pave way for them to go to Atlantic Ocean and dip their Quran inside it. Of course, we all know what that means. Of course, you understand what our language is. And that is exactly what they are doing today. Killing people. Using terrorists to destroy the life of ordinary people. And if you will confront the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom today, they will tell you that their brothers are not terrorists. They will tell you that their brothers, they call them brothers, misguided brothers. They are not terrorists. And to be a fan all around the world, you must understand it. That in their eyes, there is difference between terrorists. Very, very important that we Biafrans will understand this. In their eyes, there is difference between terrorism and jihadism. Jihadism is what they use to push for their quest. I'm not saying it because that is what it is, but I'm telling you exactly what they think. In their eyes, jihadism is, I would say, one of their military wing they use in pushing for their quest. And if you confront them about it, to them, it is not a terrorism. But these people, they are killing people. They are destroying the livelihood of people, ordinary people, the indigenous people in that contraption. Everybody keep mute about it. No one is saying anything about it. Our leader came out to speak about it. They say, bring him, kill him, destroy him. He is this, he is that. They got information that our leader is somewhere in Africa country. Those that call themselves elites, those that call themselves governors, those that call themselves senators, and the rest of them, they all contributed money to kidnap our leader. And the question we need to ask, John, for example, you ask the question, how much money did these people donated or contributed in making sure that our leader is kidnapped? In millions of dollars. They contributed this money. But they contributed this money in your streets, you have no good roads. They contributed this money in millions of dollars, but in Biafra land, we don't have electricity. We don't have good schools. I know you might have seen children in school when it is raining. I hope you've seen that video. You go to hospitals, patient is in the hospital bed, the rain, I'm so ashamed to say all of these things. Hospital bed, the patient is in the hospital bed, and the rain is penetrating inside the hospital. What did the patient have to do? The whole patient, they are scampering for safety. You will see them moving one corner inside the hospital. And these people, they have the guts to contribute money to go and bring back our leader, to go and kidnap our leader from a foreign country. And you expect everything to be okay. You expect everything to be all right. They call themselves elite. They call themselves all manner of name or Hanese. Name their stupid name they are bearing. Of course, you must pardon me when I say they are stupid. Of course, that is exactly what they are. Money that is meant to take care of their own people. Money that is meant to build roads. Money that is meant to make sure there is electricity. money that is meant to make sure that the children are going to school, not just going to school, but they must have the proper education. But all of these things, you can't find it anywhere. You can't find it because those that call themselves leaders, those people that call themselves leaders, the money that was meant for all of these projects is in their pockets. The money that was made to take care of the people of Biafra, they have taken it to do whatever they wish. This morning, dear friends, this morning, I am saying to dear friends that if you don't escape your mind in any way, shape, or form, that Nigerian government is a government of debt, it must be crumble. Nigerian government is a government of debt that is killing our people. Nigerian government is a government of debt that use all their wings, all their front line to destroy the life of ordinary people, the life of the indigenous people in that contraption. Nigerian government is a government of debt that do not even care about the people they are ruling. That is exactly what it is. They don't care about the people that they are ruling. They use their military to kill their own people. They use their police to kill their own people. They use their judicial system also to imprison ordinary people. Their terrorists as well, they use them to destroy the life of ordinary people. Very, very important that you know that Nigerian government is not for you. Very, very important that you know that Nigerian government is not for anybody. Nigerian government has to come to an end. Nigerian government, I won't say Nigerian government, the whole Nigeria has to come to an end. Then everybody will go on their own and take care of themselves. Because the amount of life that these people are wasting is very, very alarming. Very, very important that you know that. Nigerian government is a government of debt. Nigerian government is a government of Mieti Allah. Mieti Allah is the one pushing very hard to make sure they dip their Quran in Atlantic Ocean. Mieti Allah is the same people pushing those that are coming in into the community of the indigenous people, killing them, destroying their crops. They are the one in charge, making sure that they have Ruga all over the place in your land so that they will take you on. Nigerian government is a government of Janjaweed, of course you know. You can see what is happening in the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. You can see how Nigeria is bubbling because of their incompetence. Nigerian government is a government of terrorists. Everybody knows that. The whole world knows. They see. They know what is happening. But they don't want to say nothing because they are benefiting from the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. I won't even say they are benefiting from Nigeria. They are benefiting from Biafra land. That is the reason why they will keep their mouth mute, to count on our mistakes so that they will revive the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom once more to continue in milking be affront. But I say to them, you have something else coming. Nigerian government is a government of terrorists. Of course, we all know that answer up is empty. Each time you say it, they want to make mockery of you. If time will say that Nigerian government, or each time we say that Tansurok is empty, they'll be looking at you as safe. Something is wrong with you. But in the real sense of it, that is the truth. That is nothing but the truth. Tansurok is empty. Nigeria is bankrupt, as you can see it today. As you can see it today. Nothing is working. Nothing is working in that contraption. Those that are doing business in Zoological Republic, they have run away. They have taken their money away. That is exactly what is happening in Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. And as you all may know, or in case you already know, that the only thing that is holding the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom is their terrorists in their army and police uniform. That is the only thing holding the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. Their terrorists with AK-47 is only thing holding the Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. Of course, you all know that Nigeria is bankrupt. They keep on borrowing. They keep on borrowing. Nigeria itself is borrowing. Even the governors are also borrowing. Borrowing money for flyover. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. They are borrowing. Nigeria is bankrupt. You must know that. And if you don't know that Nigeria is bankrupt, you have something coming. Because all this money that they are borrowing, those that they borrow money from, they can decide to do whatever they want. They can decide to come to Zoological Republic and take you over. Nothing you can do. Because they say that the money that they have borrowed, the money that Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom has borrowed, in the next 100 years, they can pay it. This is exactly what we are supposed to be putting in their face. This is exactly what we are supposed to be presenting to them. They are very, very crafty. Very, 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 very crafty, I must say. This is the line that we are supposed to be going, but they cock up so many things to distract us not to be doing exactly what we're supposed to be doing. But I tell you, Almighty Chukwuoki Kabiama is in heaven. He is watching. He is watching what is going on here on earth. Dear friends, even those that call themselves a Nigerian, very, very important that you know that Nigeria is bankrupt. Nigeria is dead. Their governors are saying that to you. They are not telling me, but they are telling you that Nigeria is at the point of no return. They are saying it, and you must know it. You must use your senses. Biafrans, friends of Biafrans, lovers of freedom, This morning, I want to call our attention back to what we are doing. I want to call on our attention unto what our leader have said long, long time ago. Our leader have said so many things in time past. But I'm going to bring this morning, a few of them, that you may know the importance of what we are doing. That you may know the importance why we are screaming Biafra. We are requesting Biafra. We are asking for Biafra, that you may know why. Our leader said that Biafra that we are pursuing, Biafra that we are pursuing today, he said, it is more important. It is more important than every other thing you may think. Every other thing you may think. Biafra is more important than your money. Biafra is more important than that car that you're pursuing or looking forward to acquire. Biafra is more important than, should I say, those good women. Biafra is more important than those property that you're looking to acquire. Biafra is more important than every other things you may think of. Biafra is more important than every other thing you may think. Biafra that we are asking for is the kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam here on earth. Biafra that we proclaim, Biafra that we preach, Biafra that we are asking for. Biafra that I am preaching this morning, our leader say, it is more important than every other thing that you may think of. Biafra is the kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam here on earth. Biafra is the kingdom of Almighty, the God that created heaven and earth. Biafra is the kingdom of Almighty Chukwuka Ikeabiam here on earth. To some of us, we may already know what I'm about to say, or to some of us, we don't know. But I'm going to say it anyway. The kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam will come down here on earth, and it will live forever and ever. The kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam will come down here on earth. It will live forever and ever. And me and you as a human being, me and you as man that we are today, you and I, we will live. We will die, but the kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam will remain everlasting to everlasting. Don't you think about what Biafra is? Don't you think the location of Biafra, the center of the whole world, the center of the whole universe, don't you think about it? Don't you ask yourself, where was that place that Almighty used to come down and fellowship with first ever man that was created? Where was that place? Don't you ask yourself a question? Biafra that we are asking for is more important than every other thing. Biafra that we are asking for is more important than every other thing that you may think of. Biafra that we are preaching is the kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam here on earth. And I tell you, we as a human being, we will live all our life here on earth. We will also die, but the kingdom of Chukwuka Ikeabiam will remain everlasting to everlasting. Very, very important that we know this. Very, very important that we have this in our hearts. Very, very important that we meditate in it, because it is nothing but the truth. This morning, before we go any further, I will say to Biafrans all around the world, friends of Biafrans, lovers of freedom, that you all should come together this morning and bow down your head as we pray. As we pray and commit this program this morning to the hands of Almighty, that He alone will come and guide our utterances, that He alone will come and take control in what we do. Yeah. That Almighty Chukwu Kikabia will come and take control in what we do. Remember, the prayer is the key to what we do. As you bow down your head this morning for prayer, like always, I will say to us, let us go to our leader for him to lead us in prayer. Let us pray.
As long as we come on air every evening, the whole world must listen. As long as we preach this very gospel, Chukwu Kikabia must be with us. Therefore, without any further hesitation, we must proceed to offer every prayer to Chukwu Kikabia, who resided in heaven. Therefore, as we always commence, not from today, but from of old, our Father who art in heaven, Nanin Kebine Libre, Kahayedin Song, that your name may be hallowed by men, that we may bow at the mention of it, that we may offer every glory unto thee, that we may offer you every adoration and adulation, because there is none like thee. You fight our battles for us. Every blessed day you demonstrate through your kindness and your everlasting mercy that you are our Lord, our God, and our Creator. This evening we offer these your children unto thee. All over this very planet that you created, they are listening across the entire 24 time zones on this very planet where they inhabit. They are listening to your gospel this very evening, this gospel of redemption, a gospel of hope, a gospel of restoration, a gospel of renewal, this very gospel of freedom, this very gospel of emancipation, as only you ordained, that this very gospel must be preached, that mankind may be set free from the eternal damnation of the creation of the British. My goodness me, I want to remain in the spirit, because we must worship heaven. We answer your name, O Lord of hosts. Everything about us is designed to offer glory unto thee. We have atoned for our sins last year. This very year, we have not only atoned for our sins, we have spilled, we have shed blood, they have shed our blood. We have let our sacrifice be made unto thee. Even on the 30th of August, as we are being felled by the bullets of the enemy, by the workers of iniquity and of darkness, we remain very strong today to beckon upon thee, to ask you for your mercy and for your grace, to ensure that your kingdom is restored upon the face of the earth, that you can bring your healing hand to bear upon the life of both of them that you created for one singular purpose, and that purpose alone, which is to worship you in truth and in every honesty. Is there any way that we have erred? Is there any way that our ancestors may have sinned? We confess before a congregation of the whole of humanity to ask you, O Lord of hosts, to have mercy upon us. You must have mercy upon us. We have suffered enough. We have been subjugated enough. We have been tortured enough. We have been imprisoned enough. We did not do these people anything. Our only crime is to answer your name. Our only crime is to be born your children. Our only crime is to excel at everything that we place our hands into. Our only crime is to exhibit your glory and your blessing, which manifestedly is upon our lives every blessed day. That is why they want to kill us. That is why the British want to join those of them who don't know you, to destroy your creation and your inheritance. You will not allow shame to befall your name. You will not allow the enemies to triumph over the lives of your children, because you created us to exist, to worship, to honor, and to praise you. That is exactly what we are going to do when this Biafra comes. It will come in truth and in every honesty, because we will remain every blessed day Chukwa Biama Benigo whiter than white and whiter than snow. Is there any way that we have sinned that you cannot forgive us our trespasses, to enable us to fulfill your own word which was spoken thousands of years ago, that instead of what you promised not to come to pass, that heaven and earth will cease to exist. You opened your mouth, Shukotika Biyama, to bless mankind to the coming of Yahushua, who came here and said, let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Those words can never be in vain, because they are anchored upon your holiness and your magnificence. That is why in the end we know that Biafra will come, that these children that we have given birth to all over the world, and their children, and their children, and their children, as long as they give birth to them, and they are Biafrans, they will worship you in truth and honesty. Through this very work we are doing, mankind will come to understand you. Let your miracle be wrought in our lives. Let us witness and behold your magnificence, your holiness, your mystery, and your grace. Under our command, O Lord of hosts, we call upon you. We call upon you to heal. We call upon you to provide succor to those of them who are inconsolable. We ask you to come and strengthen those who are weak. We ask you to restore hope where there is hopelessness. We ask you for inclusion where there is destitution. We ask you for one brotherhood, one camaraderie, one bone, one blood, and one flesh of your children. The ethics and the Biblio, the Ivan, the Shekiri, the Isobos, and also those of them from Isoko. We are traveling all the way to the lands of Igala. We are moving on from there to Idoma, to Igede, to the territories of the Igbo land. All these places we dedicate unto thee. All these lands of yours, we ask you to cover it with your mercy, because Biafra will come, and when it does, we will dance on the streets. I'm telling you, by the time that we are done, humanity will think that we are mad, we are drunk in your glory, and rightfully so, because your kingdom will come to rest upon this very earth. That very kingdom is the unadulterated, non-negotiable sovereignty of the Republic of Biafra. That may be fulfilled in our time. We will tell you the most original thing. All this we pray, all this we ask for, in no other name apart from that name that belongs to you. I have a sincere behavior, you say, my name is Nnamdi Kanu. I am the leader of indigenous people of Biafra all over this very planet, I tell you. I lead indigenous people of Biafra, I do. So also do I command the armies of Biafra. They are fiercely loyal. They are loyal, I tell you, and doing the work that I expect them to do. I also direct Radio Biafra, not through any power which I possess or any extraordinary knowledge, but by your grace, O Lord. by your grace, Chikwoke Kabiama, when you're not Isiala Nefe, we honor you and we adore you. I know that some people listening, including the British, may not understand what we are doing, but there is nobody in Britain that answers much to the child of heaven. We do. Therefore, when we worship our Father, people should not try to be jealous. They should not feign ignorance or misunderstanding, because we are ancient people. We have been doing this for over 5,000 years, and we'll continue to do so until the end of time.
Say we know they come back again. We they come back bigger, stronger, and better this time around, my brother. Indigenous people of Biafra IPOB don't come again with Obungalicious, acrobatic, Dumbakalakoshik movement action. This one go break everywhere. Now, earthquake, in they come. This earthquake, they different types. So the first one go come, the second one go come, the third one go come, and the one will go turn the zoo upside down, and we go make the world vibrate. They come. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, my country people of Biafra, on 1st of October, this announcement is so important that you must carry your seat, carry your bench, carry everything, come around, come sit down, come hear what you talk. For 1st of October, nothing like March Past, nothing like anything, nothing like a movement in Biafra land. No school go March Past, no motor go wrong. Now total lockdown, sit at home, proper. On that day, 1st October, any school, any motor, we try them. Anything where you see, now your fault. We no one see fly. We no one see your fowl for road. We no one see your goat. We no one see any shop for street open. After we don't talk, people go say, okay, now so they did. Eh, as in the they talk now, oh, what they bury. Then they gamma, what they bury on this one. Where will they talk now? But make we tell you exactly what thing will happen. From that 1st of October, we will no one see any zoo flag for any building, for any establishment, for any school, for any church, anywhere at all, except for bank. Draw your ear. The only place where we live say, let this zoo flag remain, na banks. Any other place, no more. Here and now, if we catch you, you go do salute, you go do night pass. The school, we go deal with them. The principal, we go deal with them. The motorway carrier, we go deal with them. Because now we don't come out, we say we don't come out. You think say we don't go back, we never go back. Because if la 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 is with us, my neck will bring this notice to you. This message, they come from the indigenous people of Biafra, the owners of the land, the owners of the land, the original owners of the land. Under the leadership of Mazen Nnamdi Kanu, of Hamadi Kewan, the man that has reduced every nonsensical nonsense and garbage from the zoo with the tenure.
We are here to ensure that the death of 3.5 million people is not forgotten.
Right, welcome back. All right, dear friends, wherever you may be hearing my voice from, wherever you are listening from, it is once more, once again, a very, very wonderful morning from me, from here, to each and every one of us. And I am also welcoming each and every one of us to this breakfast show this morning. Invite your friends, invite everybody, because it is going to be awesome. All right, this morning I just want us to look into one or two headlines this morning before we go ahead. Before we go forward, I want to look into one or two headlines, making headline in that Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. That is exactly what it is. Here it says, power shift. Your position unconstitutional. The North governors reply to the South. All right. We have been hearing these people talking about presidency to the South, presidency to the so where they wherever they want it to be. But here they have responded. Your position unconstitutional. The North governors reply the South. All right. I don't want to go into that one. Let me look into something else here. Here, I have it here. There is another headline here that I'm looking. It says, Zamfara residents lament. All right. Please hold on. Let me get it once more. All right. Here it says, Zamfara residents lament indefinite telecom shutdown. Oh yeah, I'm trying to put it together. All right. Zamfara residents. Zamfara's residents lamented indefinite telecom shutdown. Aimed rise in bandits. Shut down the telecom service. They shut it down because of the bandits. I don't know what country is this. Right. I don't want to go into this one also. I'm looking for something that I want to use to talk to those that call themselves one Nigerianist. All right. So many things is happening in Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. Yeah, I saw on this one, they said we must provide decent job or face several consequences in Gigi 1. This one is on Vanguard. All right, I'm trying to see if I can get these things together. I keep going off and all right. All right. I have this one here. It says how soldiers sell arm to survive in the northeast. All right, how the soldiers sell their arm to survive in northeast. This is Nigerian newspaper reporting this. How soldiers sell their arm to survive in northeast by naval officer commando. All right, a naval officer Commodore Jamila Malafa yesterday revealed how soldiers deployed for the anti-insurgency to fight the Northeast sell arm to survive. Now, I hope those that call themselves Nigerians hope they are listening to what is happening. They will send these people, of course it is on record that this Nigerian government, they will select group of people, and push them to go and fight Boko Haram. When those soldiers might have gotten there, they will set them up by telling Boko Haram where they are. This is things that is happening. But this one now, I think maybe they have something, you know, something along the line, they get to understand that Nigerian project is not what dying. What are they doing now? They are selling their weapon. They will sell their weapon and take care of themselves first instead of go there and die that is already dead. Very, very important. This is not me making it up. If you go to Vanguard, I saw this news on Vanguard. If you go on Vanguard, you will see this very news. This is a breaking news about 4 hours ago. I didn't make it up. How soldiers sell arm to survive in Northeast by naval officer. He is one of the real days to them. Unbelievable. When they tell you that Nigeria is gone, you don't quite understand it. All right, let me go to this one. This one here, this man in River State. All right, let me go to the news. Nigeria is gone, River State governor. I don't know if he is lamenting. I don't know why he is telling you this today. But this same man is the same man that has been listening to our leader time after time after time after time. Over and over that our leader keep on repeating that Nigeria is a government. The government that is controlling Nigeria today is a government of death. Government that are killing their own people. Look at him now. He is here now. I don't know if I don't know what I will call it. Is he giving you prophecy or he is lamenting? Which one will I call it? Nigeria is gone by River State governor. A man that come from River. All right, let me go into the news, but I'm not going to go so deep into it. But I just want to read maybe one or two paragraphs. Here he says, Governor Nelson Wike of River State has said Nigeria is at a point of extinction. Underline that word. I know, I hope you know what extinction means. Something that in a snap of a finger they will disappear. That is exactly what that word means. Governor Nelson Wike of River State has said Nigeria is at a point of extinction, that only God, not man, can revise the impending disintegration. This is his word. When you go to Icons News, you will see this very headline by Nwike. The governor stated this at the International Church Service in commemoration of the 61st independence anniversary of Nigeria at St. Paul Anglican Church, Port Harcourt, River State, I beg your pardon, on Sunday is when he said this. Wiki said, it is regrettable that at 61, Nigeria still Wiki said, it is regrettable that at 61, Nigeria still grapples with leadership failure. Vanguard also reports. All right, I'm going to leave it here. It is very, very important right now to everybody that Nigeria is gone. Like Nweke is saying, I am not the one saying it. He is a governor. There are so many intelligence reports that he gets that you, bare ordinary people, do not get. So this man knows exactly what is happening. This man knows exactly what is happening. That is the reason why he is out. To tell you that Nigeria is gone. Nigeria is gone. Nigeria is at the point, of disintegration. I hope we all will understand what this man is trying to put across. Or try to tell us, because it is not every day you'll be getting an inside from inside. Somebody that is inside, he is out to tell you what is happening. Very, very important that we know. Nigeria is gone. Nigeria is gone. The people in charge of the affair of Nigeria, they have nothing in their head. They don't know what to contribute. They don't know how to make sure the country moves where it's supposed to be. They don't know how to take care of their own citizens. Rather, they kill their people. They kill their own people. They destroy the life of their own people. Rather, the money that is meant to take care of their own people, they will share it. As a matter of fact, speaking about money, because we call these people our leaders, we call them names, senator, names that they are bearing. Instead of them taking care of their own people. All right, please forgive me for that. instead of them to take care of their own people, instead of them to do what they need to do to make sure things is going smoothly for their own people first, because that is exactly what they're supposed to be doing. No, they will not do that. No, they will not do that. They are fond of sharing money. That is exactly what you get out of that Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom. They are fond of sharing money. Sharing money every time they are fond of sharing money. They are sharing money, hiding the money. Over there in the north, their Gumi is busy protecting their people. Gumi is busy protecting their people. What did he say? What did he say to Nigerians? He won't say that Fulani are not going anywhere. As a matter of fact, I just want to give you the clip. I just want to play the video so that you hear it. Because these days, everybody have a question to ask. Everybody want to hear it before they believe it. Just listen to this man, what he said about the terrorists and Fulanis. Just listen. I'm going to play it. Very good. Now listen. The herdsmen, they are going nowhere.
We are part of us and we are part of them.
That is not true.
We must
that is true.
Live with them.
I hope you understand what this man is saying. The herdsmen, the same herdsmen that is killing our people. He said they are going nowhere. Of course, all of you remember when they come out and say these people, these herdsmen that is killing people, they are not Nigerians. This man said the herdsmen that is killing people, they are not Nigerians. They came from wherever they came from. And this man is here saying to you, herdsmen, they are going nowhere. Of course, you also remember the short man, the short governor in the north. He said he tried to locate those Fulani that came from outside Nigeria killing people. He located them and he paid them money to stop killing. All of these things is what we is it what we are what we all will put up with. People that drink blood of their fellow human being. Is it what me and you will put up to? Of course not. Biafra is already here. Like Wike said to you, that Nigeria is at the point of disintegration. Enjoy the voice
of God. And they can't drive us away. They are our neighbors, so we should never allow them to be our enemies. And if we are enemy states by our actions, we are turning into enemies, then we are finished.
I just don't want to listen to this crack, this nonsense story that this man is saying. Someone that came from outside, an outsider, invade your country, invade your homeland, and you're telling me to allow him, that he is part of you. What a mess. What a story you have to tell. It is for you to know. I can go and on and on and on to bring to you what is crumbling the Zoological Republic. I can go on and on and on and on to give you the catalyst that is rocking Nigeria today. They are numerous. They are numerous. You can't fix it. You can't do anything about it. The only way is to pull down that zoological republic of animal kingdom. That is just a simple way to fix it. Pull it down, everybody, to your tent, O Israel. Pull it down. When you listen to these kinds of talk from these people, you can't help yourself but to think of Biafra. That is the only thing you have to think about. Biafra is only what we are supposed to be saying or talking or discussing, if I will use that word. Not if I. Biafra is the only discussion that we are supposed to be discussing right now. That is just the simple way to say it. Wiki have said it to you. Nigeria is at the blink. At the blink of disintegration. And we all are busy doing something else. This will take me to something, to a video that I saw on Facebook. I don't want to mention the name of this man, but I just want to address it a little bit. I used to see this man picture on Facebook. You know, I respect him for his look. But this man made this video. He said he is 63 years old. I don't want to mention no name, but the person that I'm talking about, he know himself. He said all kinds of things. He said so many things that I don't want to touch right now. But what I want to say is, this man said, bring this person out. Bring this person out. Let's DOS. Bring two of them. Put them on radio, maybe on Facebook Live. Let them ask them question. Then we will listen. Then we will listen. And this man is supposed to be an elder. I am not just, I really want you to listen closely so that you understand what I am saying. This man said he is 63 years old and you are an elder. You are in America. Because of the problems that we are having, and you don't know how to go about it. The only way you will go about it is coming up, making a video, telling us, telling DOS to bring this one and bring this one, and we should sit on radio or Facebook Live. Then they will ask them question. Then you will listen. Now, I want you to understand me. I am not saying asking them a question is a bad thing, but I really want you to understand where I'm going to. You made reference about the teachings of our leader. How our leader teaches. How people are enjoying it, but they are not learning anything from it. Sir, with all due respect, I think you did not learn anything as well. The reason being what I'm about to say. You said, bring them out on air, ask them question, let them answer. Last Shabbat ago, Mazio Foma was on air. He said so many things. And he said, we have a panel that will take care of all of these things. I don't want to make any mistake. I want to call the name exactly how he called it, but I don't want to make any mistake, so I'm going to leave it there. There is a structure. Mazio Foma said he himself, he called these people and asked them if this case came to them. These people that he is calling up, just a group of lawyers. This is another office of his own that our leader set up for this kinds of thing. But they didn't go there. sir. I'm just adding all of this. It's just a spice for you to understand exactly where I'm going. Because you said, call them out on radio, call them out on Facebook Live, ask them a question, then we will listen. Hold on, you will see where I'm going to. Now, our leader also referred to us on Taliban. Did you see how they take over their country? Did you see how they take over their country? Remember when they were fighting the Americans? America called them terrorists, and the whole world followed suit in branding them terrorists. I am not saying any other thing, but I am just painting a picture for you to understand, sir. And all right, please hold on for me. All right, here, you know what I am saying is just a picture that I'm painting for you to understand exactly what I'm saying. Here in the land, here in Israel, Nigerian government, just because, of course, before I go any further, of course, you know that Nigerian government that we are fighting, they branded us terrorists. Of course, the whole world do not follow suit in calling us terrorists. Just some people are the people that agree to what Nigeria say, but the whole world entirely do not brand us terrorists, unlike the Taliban. The whole world follows suit in calling them terrorists. Follow me closely. Here in Israel, for the fact that Nigerian government wants to shut down Radio Biafra, do you know how much money they spend in buying up the sat link that is carrying our signal? Do you know how much? This money is in dollar, in billions of dollars, just to buy off that company that is carrying our signal. In dollars, in billions of dollars. What happened after they might have bought the South Link? Chukwu Okikabiama is in heaven. He is watching every move we humans make. After they might have finished acquiring the company or buying off the company, the satellites fly off. Nobody knows where the satellite is. I'm painting a picture, like I said earlier on. And also, this Taliban that our leader made reference of, he said he didn't ask us to be terrorists, but he said we should develop their mindset. Taliban, they fought for 20 years, if not more. And in the process, they are raising money. But you and you and you all over the world, you did not know about it. But they are doing it silently, raising their money, fighting, losing their men. So many people died. I swear Americans also lose their men as well. And at the end, after they might have gotten what they are fighting for, that is when they publish. That is when they publish their financial deed, every single thing, how they raise their money and the rest of them, they publish it. And you also know, sir, that Nigerian government is pursuing IPOB, bomber to bomber. Everything we do, they will go and look into it. Anywhere we go, they will go and ask questions. Anyhow we do things, they will try to make sure they undo what we are doing. And you, sir, you are saying that we should come on air and start to ask questions about our finances. The Zoological Republic of Animal Kingdom will know everything about our finances. It is a picture that I paint. If you have Akonuchi, of course you are an able man. If you have Akonuchi, Wereregi, Iregi, Go Ezege Ono. If you have Akonuchi, Wereire, Go Ezege Ono. For the fact that I have said all of these things doesn't mean that I am supporting whomever that is doing evil in IPOB. Anybody that is doing evil in IPOB, it doesn't matter how much money you steal, when the time comes, you will give accountable for it. That is the reason why our leader puts so many structures in place. He puts so many structures in place, like the one that I just mentioned. The people that are in this office are a group of lawyers, like Major Former said. These are the things that we are not supposed to bring out, but because of course they say, na condition, I make the fish bend. It is because of the condition that we are in, that is the reason why all of these things are coming out. You want us to come out and start asking questions. But our leader has put structure in place to take care of all of these things. The people that are in this office, they said this matter did not come to them. But rather it is on Facebook. You are pushing for DOS to bring it on air and ask them a question that you may listen. Forget that as you are listening, Nigerian government is also listening. And one question that I want to ask right now is, we all say that we are following our leader. We all say our leader is our leader. We all say we are counting for him to release, to come out of the jail. Have you ever asked your question, what are they asking our leader? What offer are they making to our leader? Now I can say this to you from my own, that is on my own intelligence. Do you know what they are asking our leader? For the fact that for a couple of months now it has been ESN and the fund. On my own intelligence, what they are asking our leader is the structure of ESN and our financial, how will I put it to us, and where our finances are. That is exactly what they are asking our leader. Of course, history is going to prove me right, because that is exactly what it is. This morning, I really want Biafrans all around the world, friends of Biafrans, to look into what we are doing and take it more important. Look into what we are doing, Biafrans, and make sure that Biafra that we are pursuing is more important than every other things. Anybody that does what is not supposed to be done, at some point, you will pay for it. But this morning, I want to charge Biafrans all over the world, friends of Biafrans, that we should put hands together and make sure that freedom that we are asking for is what we shall get. I want us all to put our hands together and make sure that we fight and make our leader out. That we fight and get this freedom that we are asking for. It's just like a step. Just a little step, because one of theirs in Governor Wike in River State, he said Nigeria is at a point. Of course, you know what point is. This morning, because of the time, this is where I would draw the curtain for today. And I know that what I said make sense to us. Or you find sense in what I'm saying, I would say, please, be our friends. Let us think on what we are doing. Let us think about what we are doing. Let us all retrieve our steps and take the right step so that Almighty Chukwuki Kabiamada, at least in heaven, will help us and take us to Biafra land. Like I said, this is where I am going to draw the curtain for today, dear friends. May Almighty Chukwuki Kabiamada live in heaven. He will keep on blessing those that are working diligently with their hearts, doing the needful, preaching the gospel of Chukwuki Kabiamada according to the restoration of Biafra. Almighty in heaven, he will not abandon our leader. He will bring out our leader because our leader has done nothing wrong. I call on Biafrans, friends of Biafrans, let us gather around our leader. Let us do exactly how our leader has commanded, or how he has taught us, or how he has said that we should do it. Because from day one, he has not disappointed us. Rather, we are the one disappointing him. This morning, my call is for us to retrieve our steps and take the right step so that it shall be well with us, Biafra. In no time, trust me when I say this, in no time, we all are going home. And I will leave it here. And I will say thank you very much, Biafran, for listening this morning, for making this wonderful show a wonderful one. Almighty Chukwuki Kabiamada lives in heaven. He will bless Biafrans and Biafran people all around the world. In Chukwuki Kabiamada's name, I have prayed. And I will say, like our leader say, to those of you that has come and love the truth that you hear, that truth that you love, that truth that you hear and you've loved it, that truth will guide you, that truth will protect you, preserve you in all you do. And in all we do in this week that we are in, Almighty Chukwuki Kabiamada will continue to bless you, bless me, bless our leader, bless everybody that is working with his whole heart. In Chukwuki Kabiamada's name, I have prayed. You see. Shalom from here, dear friends. May Chukwuki Kabiamada bless us all.
By me, yeah. There is nothing that will do to me, yeah. Not today, not tomorrow, that will make me come back. When we started to remember our heroes that have passed on, they said we are wasting our time, that we will never succeed, it will never catch on. But they keep forgetting one simple thing, that the foundations of IPOB was anchored on the promise of Chukwuki Kabiamada.
Yes.
That this very noble family, this very great movement, was not instigated nor started by any human being. It is the handiwork of Chukwuki Kabiamada. Yes. And that is why we remain indestructible. Yes. That is why we remain indivisible. Yes. That is why nobody, no matter who you are, can dent our resolve and our determination to restore Biafra in this life.
Yes. Man from the heavens, that's what you are. Man from the heavens.
And you were now Basso's Yoma Chineke. Okay, Zipazo. Will you be an Devil Mahi? If I knew Guanyin.
Sabo. On your bed, Yosu.
These are the people that the Fulanese gave to you to rule over you. They started it with Ohanaeze in 1976. Every leader you have had until the coming of IPOB, anybody who's ever stood up to proclaim the defense of our people, we are planted there by the Fulani North. But you wouldn't know. That is why when they close down Iguacha seaport, they will not speak. That is why when they close Enugu airport, you don't hear anybody saying anything. That is why Calabar seaport is not functioning. That is why Warri seaport is not opened. That is why we are being forced to travel abroad. That is why no industries are opened in our land. Because they have an agenda. They have a plan. They want to depopulate our land. They want to demoralize us. They want to decimate us. They want to render us hopeless and useless.
God forbid. Ah, look, hello. Abomination forever.
But IPOB said no. Chukwukike Abiamah that set up IPOB said no. And that is why we must remain resolute and determined. That is why we must not falter. Doubt nor allow our resolve to be undermined.
Yes.
We must remain resolute.
Yes, sir.
We must remain determined.
Yes, sir.
Because one thing is certain. As night follows day, so shall Biafra be restored.
Yes.
Therefore I say unto all of you gathered here today, that the forces fighting IPOB is many. Those that want us to fail are more powerful than we are. They are more resourceful than we are. They have more money than we do. And they are determined to keep us as their slaves. But it will never happen. Those chains of bondage and of slavery has been broken by IPOB.
Forever.
That is why Biafra will come, and that is why the events happening here today in Atlanta, Georgia, United States of America, we will all sit back home to talk about it. We will all sit in the land of Biafra to talk about things like this. We shall sit in the land of Biafra to tell our children what we pass through. Because the doubting Thomases will come. You know, for the name hand, there was a three hand balloter.
I guess the plenty for very soon.
They will never stop fighting us. And as long as we remain determined and focused, there is no way they will ever succeed.
Never.
If you stop now agitating for Biafra, those you left back home will die.
Yes.
Never.
Truth.
I know you have not come with your pen and paper because I'm not on air.
We do.
I want you to write it down on a piece of paper. If you stop what you're doing, our people will die.
Yes.
You are right.
Because when it starts happening, I will tell you on the 30th of May 2019 at Martin Luther King Jr. Center in Atlanta, I told you so.
Yes.
And I'm a man. Spirit in human
flesh. If you stop now, your children will never go home.
God forbid.
If you stop now, the effort and the sacrifice of our dead will be in vain. For their sake, we will restore Biafra.
Yes.
For their sake, Biafra will stand in Africa.
Yes.
For the sake of the dead, we will build a civilization to surpass every other civilization in Africa.
Yes.
And that is what our enemies are afraid of.
Yes.
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 Yes. Especially the British.
Europeans, all of them.
Because they don't want a black man to do that thing that is the exclusive preserve of the white man.
Yes.
But we are not afraid of competition, are we?
No. Never. Never.
We are not seeking for Biafra that we may lord it over anybody else.
No.
We are not seeking for Biafra to enslave any other person.
Never.
We are not looking for Biafra.
Never.
For the sake of it.
No.
We are looking for Biafra because it is the promise of God Himself in heaven.
Truth is life.
That's where you
found.
Nobody conquered us until the British came.
Yes.
And it is not that the British conquered Biafra.
Never.
Chukwu Okike Abiyama wanted to teach us a lesson that we may return to him in truth and in every honesty.
Yes.
That his will may be done upon our lives.
Yes.
We failed in 1970 because that very foundation of divinity was missing.
Yes.
That's all. And Elohim said, I will take you up to the mountain. I will show you that very precious land of Biafra. Through our leader that we remember today. The very people's general himself. But wherever, because we are certain that he is in heaven.
Yes.
On the right hand side of God himself. Some of you don't know what he did, but we know, and we will always honor him.
Always. Forever.
As they say, what we do in life echo in history. What Ojukwu has accomplished in life will be remembered forever and ever. I say unto all of you today, you will go back to your various states, to your various cities, to your various towns. You will tell them that IPOB has come to stay. That IPOB, by the grace of God in heaven, will restore Biafra. That this same IPOB, persecuted and maligned, castigated and propagated against, that this very movement ordained in heaven for the purposes of liberation of Biafra land shall accomplish its mandate. That is why you are all here. Nothing more, nothing less. Therefore, I ask the Almighty in heaven, Chineke nanke brumihenine, onye ndi gbo n'etu ebighebi, because you have no beginning and you have no end. Onye obu nani akere ihe nile kere ke ma onwe onye kere ya. Onye dị omimi wee karịa nghọta nke mmadụ dị ndụ. Onye ndị mmụọ ozi na-akpọ isi ala nye. Ọbụla dị ndị okenye ọrụ abụọ na anọ na-atụ mkpọ ọla edo na-asị na ịdị nsọ Chineke. Na nsọ ka Jehova dị. Therefore, this very solemn assembly, to remember those that fought and died for us all over the world, starting from Japan in the east and will end in Los Angeles, California, later on today, that their spirit, O Heavenly Father, may be accepted unto heaven, because they died fighting for a noble cause. They died doing that which you compelled them to do. And because of their sacrifice, because of their pain, because of our loss upon their lives, O Heavenly Father, so will Biafra be restored, not to the glory of man, but to the glory of Chukwu Okike Abiyama Benigwe, forever and ever, we pray. IPOB,
one family.
IPOB,
one family.
IPOB,
one family.
One family.
IPOB,
one family.
IPOB,
one family.
IPOB.
My name is Mazen Nnamdi Kanu. I lead the indigenous people of Biafra. And also, I am the director of Radio Biafra and Biafra Television. And my job and my duty is to serve the people of Biafra up until the
the restoration of the stolen sovereignty of Biafra land is restored, and also to an extent to also serve Nigerian youths as well. I think since the whole protest started, we have been serving them and serving them very diligently every morning and every evening. And it is something that we should be able to continue into the foreseeable future, or until all the demands made by the young people are met by ASUROC.
Could you tell us about your background, your parentage, schools attended, and all that, please?
Schools attended, my background is quite simple. My late parents, His Royal Majesty SSI Okana, and my mom as well, Lolo Meme, Ugeze, Lolo Meme Okukano. And I went to Lab Revenue Primary School, which was a model primary school in Omaha, arguably one of the finest. And then I attended the best secondary school in the world, I believe, Fisher High School, then named Government College of Omaha, the same alma mater as Chinua Achebe, Ken Sirawiwa, and Cyprian Ekwensi, and a whole host of other people who have gone on to at least make an indelible mark in our consciousness, if not in our society. And then from there, I went to University of Nigeria and Soka, where I spent about 2 years, and they weren't doing anything that I felt enhanced my ability to understand what I was there for. I had to travel to England, where I studied politics and economics at now London Metropolitan University. I've worked in various capacities. I'm actually the owner of Alpha Phoenix Consulting Limited in the UK, which is a consultancy firm, an economic development consultancy firm. I did actually work with a lot of people like Genesis and all the rest of them, where I held managerial positions until my calling. And that calling is to help restore the kingdom of God on the face of this very earth. And that's what we've been doing for very many years now.
Fantastic. So growing up, who were your heroes, your mentors?
I think my father was number one. Only two people in my life have seriously impressed me. One was my dad, that I was very close to, that I learned a lot of things from. We never actually spoke that very often, but I used to sit around and watch him conduct his counsel, the way he adjudicated in cases and the things that he did. And most of the morals that he left me with. I remember on one occasion, I asked my father, why is it that even after Sunday service, when we get back home, normally if I go to my friend's house, and you ask after their father, they'll tell you that their dad is sleeping or doing something of that sort. But in my house, any time there's a knock on the door, my father will encourage us to open the door. And I kept wondering why. And he said, if you have nothing to hide, then you should be able to answer every knock on the door. That is why you need to keep your hands very clean. And throughout my life, apart from the time that these criminals, these savages came to my house, the police had never been to my house or the army with a hostile intent. Operation Python Dance on the 14th of September of 2017 was the very first time in my entire life that the army or the police entered my house with intention either to enforce the law or to kill or to arrest or to pillage or to destroy the very first time. So my father was number one. The second person is Thomas Sankara. The late Thomas Sankara, because of how he managed to turn Burkina Faso around from Upper Volta to Burkina Faso, and the miracle he was able to perform for the very first time in living memory, it was demonstrated that should black people put their minds to something, they can make something out of nothing. From being a basket case, they became the largest exporter of food across West Africa under the the leadership of this brilliant, 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 and very brave young man, Thomas Sankara. So just those two people.
Okay, fantastic. I think before we continue, it would be nice for me to ask if this is the real Mazi Nnamdi Kanu or the cloned one.
I can pull my ear for you. You can see I'm trying to exert as much pressure as I can. The clown in ASUROC has two ears. I only have one. You can see my glasses. I can take it off. You can see there is no other appendage anywhere behind this one. It's only one. I can pull my nose for you. You know it is me. In fact, I can even bring, if you'll pardon me, I have here with me the mask that everybody has to wear these days. You can see that my ear is not bent, is it? You can see that it's normal, it's not bent. But the clown in Asorok, when he's wearing his own mask, you see that his ear will be bent like that. Mine is not bent. So it is the real me. And of course, I have this mark here and it's unmistakable.
Yes, I just wanted to establish that you are alive because I read somewhere that you were dead. And so I wanted to be sure I'm not making history by talking to a dead man in heaven.
Not at all. I'm here alive with you on this program.
Fantastic. So could you tell me some of the books that you read that might have influenced you? I don't want to say radicalized you. I would say influenced you.
Growing up was, as with most of my peers, is Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. That is number one. Because it reminded us of who we are, where we are coming from, and where we should be heading to. So that very book was pivotal in shaping my understanding of my people and what needs to be done to rectify the damage that colonialism had done to our people. The second one I would say is Alex Haley's Roots. Again, in that very book, it reminded me or reinforced the need for the Republican zeal that burns in each and every Biafran, that we see ourselves as equal before any other race around the world, and our belief, cardinal belief, that all men are created equal before God, given the heroic sacrifice those people made at Savannah in Georgia in America many, many centuries back. I also read Leon Uris's Exodus. It's about the Jewish Holocaust and the reestablishment of the State of Israel. Again, a very decent pointer towards where Biafra should be heading to. Those three books, Things Fall Apart, Alex Haley's Roots, and Leon Uris's Exodus. They're my three favorite books here.
I've read a lot about your religious beliefs, but could you tell us about your faith?
I worship the one true God in heaven that incidentally every religion on this earth believes, or should I say worship as well. I believe I am a follower of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. I believe I worship where Jesus worshiped. I worship the same God that Jesus Christ worshipped. I praise the same God that Jesus Christ praised. And one of my favorite prayers actually was the prayer that Jesus prayed when he was asked to teach the disciples how to pray. And he said, "Our Father who art in heaven," which goes to confirm the supremacy of Almighty God in heaven, bar none, the name above all names. And it is exactly the religion of my forefathers. My ancestors worshiped God and God alone. We answer Nwachukwu. From the names we give our children, we glorify God. And if you go to my village right now, all you hear about Ikechukwu or the Nakachukwu, everything is about God. So I don't need to be tutored or to be told by anybody who God is, because God is ever present in our lives, and that is the God that I worship. Sometimes people tend to mistake it because the only modern interpretation of that very religion is Judaism. The only modern interpretation of this ancient religion is modern day Judaism. So that is why I tend to gravitate towards Judaism. But as I said, I am a follower of the teachings of Jesus Christ. But I practice Judaism in the main.
I was privileged to meet the late Chief Chukwuemeka Odumegwu Ojukwu in his lifetime. In fact, Ovation had exclusive access to his wedding, to his wife, Lady Bianca. What was your relationship with him? Did you ever meet him? And did you draw inspiration whatsoever from him?
Yes, he is our eternal leader. And that was the title that I gave to him in recognition of the very stellar work that he did trying to save a people that didn't want to be saved. And also, I had come in contact with him in London. We invited himself, Peter Obi Chekwa Asokoro, to come to London. That was in the year 2002, if I'm not mistaken. And I consider it an honor that where he stayed, the hotel he stayed in London, I paid for it. So I had sat with him on a few occasions and benefited from his immense counsel. The reason why we don't often, we want to honor him by restoring Biafra. And only then will the whole world know in how much esteem we actually hold him. To us, he's an icon. To us, he's our Moses. To us, he is the forebearer. To us, he is everything. And Ojukwu to us, it means a whole lot more than people can ever, ever imagine. And the few times that I sat with him and he spoke, he said a lot of things. In fact, the role that the British played during the war, he was the one that made me to actually realize what they did and the need for us to be very careful. The journalists that were interviewing him, especially from BBC, in their typewriters, were, should I say, listening devices that were transmitting everything that Ojukwu was saying all the way back to London. And that made it possible for them to sabotage that very effort, or should I say, to undermine it, especially what transpired at Aburi that we now have the tapes and records of. So I sat with him and I discussed with him, and it was very, very informative, very, very fruitful. And I learned a lot from him, something that will continue to guide me as we proceed on this very important and critical journey towards the restoration of Biafra.
Fantastic. Now we'll get to the area of my bazookas. Now it's time to fire a few bazookas at you. You've been seen by many as waging a war against your country, Nigeria, by seeking a Biafra nation. What led to your decision?
First of all, Nigeria is not my country. I was born a Biafran. My birth certificate reads Biafra, and no one has ever changed that. The fact that I was at some point or the other in possession.
First of all, pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. First of all, pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Must first of all pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. first of all pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. First of all, pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. First of all, pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Pray and commit all our dealings to Almighty Father in heaven. Pray and commit all our dealings to
by me. Yeah. There is nothing that will do to me, yeah, not today, not tomorrow, that will make me to abandon Biafra is impossible. When we started to remember our heroes that have passed on, they said we are wasting our time, that we will never succeed, it will never catch on. But they keep forgetting one simple thing, that the foundations of IPOB was anchored on the promise of Chukwuka Abiamah.
Yes.
That this very noble family, this very great movement, was not instigated nor started by any human being. It is the handiwork of Chukwuka Abiamah. And that is why we remain indestructible. That is why we remain indivisible. That is why nobody, no matter who you are, can dent our resolve and our determination to restore Biafra in this life.
Man from the heavens, that's what you are. Man from the heavens.
And you were now Basso's your machineke. Okay, Zipazo. Will you be an Devil Mahi? If I knew Guanyin. These are the people that the Fulanese gave to you to rule over you. They started it with Ohanaeze in 1976. Every leader you have had until the coming of IPOB, anybody who's ever stood up to proclaim the defense of our people, we are planted there by the Fulani North. But you wouldn't know. That is why when they close down Iguacha seaports, they will not speak. That is why when they close Enugu airports, you don't hear anybody saying anything. That is why Calabar seaport is not functioning. That is why Warri seaport is not opened. That is why we are being forced to travel abroad. That is why no industries are opened in our land. Because they have an agenda. They have a plan. They want to depopulate our land. They want to demoralize us. They want to decimate us. They want to render us hopeless and useless.
God forbid. Abomination forever.
But IPOB said no. Chukwuka Abiamah that set up IPOB said no. And that is why we must remain resolute and determined. That is why we must not falter.
Yes.
Doubt nor allow our resolve to be undermined.
Yes.
We must remain resolute.
Yes,
we must remain determined.
Yes,
because one thing is certain. As night follows day, so shall Biafra be restored.
Yes.
Therefore I say unto all of you gathered here today, that the forces fighting IPOB is many. Those that want us to fail are more powerful than we are. They are more resourceful than we are. They have more money than we do. And they are determined to keep us as their slaves. But it will never happen. Those chains of bondage and of slavery has been broken by IPOB.
Forever.
That is why Biafra will come. And that is why the events happening here today in Atlanta, Georgia, United States of America, we will all sit back home to talk about it. We will all sit in the land of Biafra to talk about things like this. We shall sit in the land of Biafra to tell our children what we passed through. Because the doubting Thomases will come. Ni you know for the name hand there was a three my hand balochadog.
I guess the pretty far very
soon. They will never stop fighting us. And as long as we remain determined and focused, there is no way they will ever succeed.
Never.
If you stop now,
Lord, pray and commit all our dealings to
those you left back home will die.
Almighty Father in heaven,
I know you have not come with your pen and paper because I'm not on air.
We do.
I want you to write it down on a piece of paper. If you stop what you're doing, our people will die.
Yes.
You are
Because when it starts happening, I will tell you on the 30th of May 2019 at Martin Luther King Jr. Center in Atlanta, I told you so.
Yes.
And I'm a
spirit in human
flesh. If you stop now, your children will never go home.
God forbid.
If you stop now, the effort and the sacrifice of our dead will be in vain. For their sake, we will restore Biafra.
Yes.
For their sake, Biafra will stand in Africa.
Yes.
For the sake of the dead, we will build a civilization to surpass every other civilization in Africa.
Yes.
And that is what our enemies are afraid of.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Especially the British.
Europeans, all of them.
Because they don't want a black man to do that thing that is the exclusive preserve of the white man.
Yes.
But we are not afraid of competition, are we?
No. Never. Never.
We are not seeking for Biafra that we may lord it over anybody else.
No.
We are not seeking for Biafra to enslave any other person.
Never.
We are not looking for Biafra.
Never.
For the sake of it. We are looking for Biafra because it is the promise of God Himself in heaven.
Truth is life.
That's where you
come.
Nobody conquered us until the British came.
Yes.
And it is not that the British conquered Biafra.
Never.
Chukwuka Biama wanted to teach us a lesson that we may return to Him in truth and in every honesty. That His will may be done upon our lives. We failed in 1970 because that very foundation of divinity was missing. That's all. And Elohim said, I will take you up to the mountain. I will show you that very precious land of Biafra through our leader that we remember today, the very people's general himself. That wherever, because we are certain that He is in heaven,
yes.
On the right hand side of God Himself. Some of you don't know what He did, but we know, and we will always honor Him.
Forever.
As they say, what we do in life echo in history.
Yes.
What Ojukwu has accomplished in life will be remembered forever and ever.
Yes.
I say unto all of you today, you will go back to your various states, to your various cities, to your various towns. You will tell them that IPOB has come to stay. That IPOB, by the grace of God in heaven, will restore Biafra. That this same IPOB persecuted and maligned, castigated and propagated against, that this very movement ordained in heaven for the purposes of liberation of Biafra land shall accomplish its mandate.
Yes.
That is why you are all here. Nothing more, nothing less. Therefore, I ask the Almighty in heaven, Chineke nanke prumihenine, because you have no beginning and you have no end. Onye obunani akere ihe nile kere ke ma nomego onye kere ya. Onye di omimi we karia ngota nke madu di ndu. Onye ndi mmozi na akpu isi ala nye. Abula di ndi okenye oru abu na anno na tumbole donasi ni di nso Chineke. Nansoka Jehovah.
Yes.
Therefore, this very solemn assembly to remember those that fought and died for us all over the world, starting from Japan in the east, and will end in Los Angeles, California, later on today. That their spirit, O Heavenly Father, may be accepted unto heaven. because they died fighting for a noble cause. They died doing that which you compelled them to do. And because of their sacrifice, because of their pain, because of our loss upon our their lives, O Heavenly Father, so will Biafra be restored, not to the glory of man, but to the glory of Chukwokika Biama Benigwe, forever and ever, we pray. IPOB! 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 One family! One family! One family!
My name is Mazen Nnamdi Kanu. I lead the indigenous people of Biafra. And also, I am the director of Radio Biafra and Biafra Television. And my job and my duty is to serve the people of Biafra up until the restoration of the stolen sovereignty of Biafra land is restored. And also, to an extent, to also serve Nigerian youths as well. I think since the whole protest started, we have been serving them and serving them very diligently every morning and every evening. And it is something that we should be able to continue into the foreseeable future or until all the demands made by the young people are met by ASUROC.
Could you tell us about your background, your parentage, schools attended, and all that, please?
Schools attended, my background is quite simple. My late parents, His Royal Majesty Ezesai Okana, and my mom as well, Lolo Meme. And I went to Lab Revenue Primary School, which was a model primary school in Omaha, arguably one of the finest. And then I attended the best secondary school in the world, I believe, Fisher High School, then named Government College Omaha, the same alma mater as Chinua Achebe, Ken Sirawiwa, and Cyprian Ekwensi, and a whole host of other people. Who have gone on to at least make an indelible mark in our consciousness, if not in our society. And then from there, I went to University of Nigeria and Soka, where I spent about 2 years and they weren't doing anything that I felt enhanced my ability to understand what I was there for. I had to travel to England, where I studied politics and economics at now London Metropolitan University. I've worked in various capacities. I'm the owner of Alpha Phoenix Consulting Limited in the UK, which is a consultancy firm, an economic development consultancy firm. I did actually work with a lot of people like Genesis and all the rest of them, where I held managerial positions until my calling. And that calling is to help restore the kingdom of God on the face of this very earth. And that's what we've been doing for very many years now.
Fantastic. So growing up, who were your heroes, your mentors?
I think my father was number one. Only two people in my life have seriously impressed me. One was my dad, that I was very close to, that I learned a lot of things from. We never actually spoke that very often, but I used to sit around and watch him conduct his counsel, the way he adjudicated in cases and the things that he did. And most of the morals that he left me with. I remember on one occasion, I asked my father, why is it that even after Sunday service, when we get back home, normally if I go to my friend's house, and you ask after their father, they'll tell you that their dad is sleeping or doing something of that sort. But in my house, any time there's a knock on the door, my father will encourage us to open the door. And I kept wondering why. And he said, if you have nothing to hide, then you should be able to answer every knock on the door. That is why you need to keep your hands very clean. And throughout my life, apart from the time that these savages came to my house, the police had never been to my house or the army with a hostile intent. Operation Python Dance on the 14th of September of 2017 was the very first time in my entire life that the army or the police entered my house with intention either to enforce the law or to kill or to arrest or to pillage or to destroy the very first time. So my father was number one. The second person is Thomas Sankara, the late Thomas Sankara, because of how he managed to turn Burkina Faso around from Upper Volta to Burkina Faso, and the miracle he was able to perform for the very first time in living memory, it was demonstrated that should black people put their minds to something, they can make something out of nothing. From being a basket case, they became the largest exporter of food across West Africa under the, the leadership of this brilliant, brilliant, brilliant and very brave young man, Thomas Sankara. So just those two people.
Okay, fantastic. I think before we continue, it would be nice for me to ask if this is the real Mazi Nnamdi Kanu or the cloned one.
I can pull my ear for you. You can see I'm trying to exert as much pressure as I can. The clown in Asorok has two ears. I only have one. You can see my glasses. I can take it off. You can see there is no other appendage anywhere behind this one. It's only one. I can pull my nose for you. You know it is me. In fact, I can even bring, if you'll pardon me, I have here with me the mask that everybody has to wear these days. You can see that my ear is not bent, is it? You can see that it's normal, it's not bent. But the clown in Asorok, when he's wearing his own mask, you see that his ear will be bent like that. Mine is not bent. So it is the real me. And of course, I have this mark here and it's unmistakable.
Yes, I just wanted to establish that you are alive because I read somewhere that you were dead. And so I wanted to be sure I'm not making history by talking to a dead man in heaven.
Not at all. I'm here live with you on this program.
Fantastic. So could you tell me some of the books that you read that might have influenced you? I don't want to say radicalized you. I would say influenced you.
Growing up was, as with most of my peers, is Chinua Achebeze, Things Fall Apart. That is number one. Because it reminded us of who we are, where we are coming from, and where we should be heading to. So that very book was pivotal in shaping my understanding of my people and what needs to be done to rectify the damage that colonialism had done to our people. The second one I would say is Alex Haley's Roots. Again, in that very book, it reminded me or reinforced the need for the Republican zeal that burns in each and every Biafran, that we see ourselves as equal before any other race around the world, and our belief, cardinal belief, that all men are created equal before God, given the heroic sacrifice those people made at Savannah in Georgia in America many, many centuries back. I also read Leon Uris's Exodus. It's about the Jewish Holocaust and the reestablishment of the State of Israel. Again, a very decent pointer towards where Biafra should be heading to. Those three books, Things Fall Apart, Alex Haley's Roots, and Leon Uris's Exodus. They're my three favorite books here.
I've read a lot about your religious beliefs, but could you tell us about your faith?
I worship the one true God in heaven that incidentally every religion on this earth believes, or should I say worship as well. I believe I am a follower of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. I believe I worship where Jesus worshiped. I worship the same God that Jesus Christ worshiped. I praise the same God that Jesus Christ praised. And one of my favorite prayers actually was the prayer that Jesus prayed when he was asked to teach the disciples how to pray. And he said, "Our Father who art in heaven," which goes to confirm the supremacy of Almighty God in heaven, bar none, the name above all names. And it is exactly the religion of my forefathers. My ancestors worshiped God and God alone. We answer Nwachukwu, from the names we give our children, we glorify God. And if you go to my village right now, all you hear about Ikechukwu or the Nakachukwu, everything is about God. So I don't need to be tutored or to be told by anybody who God is, because God is ever present in our lives, and that is the God that I worship. Sometimes people tend to mistake it, because the only modern interpretation of that very religion is Judaism. The only modern interpretation of this ancient religion is modern day Judaism. So that is why I tend to gravitate towards Judaism. But as I said, I am a follower of the teachings of Jesus Christ. But I practice Judaism in the main.
I was privileged to meet the late Chief Chukwuemeka Odumegwu Ojukwu in his lifetime. In fact, Ovation had exclusive access to his wedding, to his wife, Lady Bianca. What was your relationship with him? Did you ever meet him? And did you draw inspiration whatsoever from him?
Yes, he is our eternal leader. And that was the title that I gave to him in recognition of the very stellar work that he did trying to save a people that didn't want to be saved. And also, I had come in contact with him in London. We invited himself, Peter Obi Chekwa Asokoro, to come to London. That was in the year 2002, if I'm not mistaken. And I consider it an honor that the hotel he stayed in London, I paid for it. So I had sat with him on a few occasions and benefited from his immense counsel. The reason why we want to honor him by restoring Biafra, and only then will the whole world know in how much esteem we actually hold him. To us, he's an icon. To us, he's our Moses. To us, he is the forebearer. To us, he is everything. And Ojukwu to us, it means a whole lot more than people can ever, ever imagine. And the few times that I sat with him and he spoke, he said a lot of things. In fact, the role that the British played during the war, he was the one that made me to actually realize what they did and the need for us to be very careful. The journalists that were interviewing him, especially from BBC, in their typewriters, were, listening devices that were transmitting everything Ojukwu was saying all the way back to London. And that made it possible for them to sabotage that very effort, or should I say to undermine it, especially what transpired at Aburi that we now have the tapes and records of. So I sat with him and I discussed with him, and it was very, very informative, very, very fruitful. And I learned a lot from him, something that will continue to guide me as we proceed on this very important and critical journey towards the restoration of Biafra.
Fantastic. Now we'll get to the area of my bazookas. Now it's time to fire a few bazookas at you. You've been seen by many as waging a war against your country, Nigeria, by seeking a Biafra nation. What led to your decision?
First of all, Nigeria is not my country. I was born a Biafran. My birth certificate reads Biafra, and no one has ever changed that. The fact that I was at some point or the other in possession of a Nigerian passport does not actually confer upon me their citizenship. I saw the Nigerian passport as a mere travel document, because my birth certificate issued at the time of my birth reads Biafra. Nobody of a sane mind will condone or accept what is happening in Nigeria. I believe that genuine attempts have been made in the past to try to remedy the wreck that Nigeria is today, but there was a palpable unwillingness on the part of the powers that be to do something about it. I detest suffering and pain. I hate to see people suffer. I hate to see people in pain. The only thing that propels me, the only thing that drives me towards this very agitation is not born out of hatred for anybody, but a desire to test freedom in our time. Nigeria was not constructed by a Yoruba man. If it were, I would have perhaps accepted. Nigeria was not created by a Fulani man. If that was the case, who knows, I may accept. Nigeria was not created by a Hausa man either. It wasn't created by a Nupe man. It wasn't created by a Gwari man. Never created by a Jukun man. Nigeria was not created by an Ijo man. Not created by an Ibibio man. Nigeria was created by a white man and named by a white woman. The name Nigeria means awful, bad, evil. It means nigger, which is a swear word, is a slur in America. If a white person calls a black person nigger, they might end up in jail. Then why should I answer a name that is abhorrent before God and before man? Nobody came from all these ethnic groups. They never got together to say, as from today, our name should be Nigeria. A white man determined that. I cannot go to England and say to English people, I want to rename Liverpool. I want to give it another name. I'm sure they'll think I'm mentally, unstable and put me in jail. Now, the problem is this. Why should Africans accept the name Nigeria? It doesn't mean anything in Yoruba language, doesn't mean anything in Hausa language, doesn't mean anything in Igbo language, but yet we are Africans. So I see it as a relic, or should I say a vestige of racism. I see Nigeria as an abomination, not just before God, but before man as well. Those with common sense, that is the reason why I like Thomas Sankara. Thomas Sankara changed the name from Upper Volta, that had no meaning, to Burkina Faso. Now, I wonder why educated, very savvy, and enlightened Nigerians cannot see it. You have half of Yoruba land in Benin Republic. Some are in Togo. For over 20 years, I have been a very vocal advocate of a Yoruba nation that will also encompass the Yorubas in Benin Republic and those in Togo, because they are Yoruba people. Wouldn't that be very wonderful? Why should white people come from Europe and decide that some Yorubas should be Togolese, some should be from Benin Republic, and some should be from Nigeria? You're a Yoruba man. What do you have in common with a Kanuri man? Absolutely nothing. But I can tell you, you have something in common with a Yoruba man in Togo. You have something in common with a Yoruba man in Benin Republic. Why should you see a Kanuri man as your fellow citizen in Nigeria, and not a Yoruba man who lives just a stone throw from Badagry? So these are the anomalies that Africans need to sit down to address. That is why we have arrested development. That is why nothing seems to be working. Because the convergence of these diverse value systems from the core area one of, from the West and from the East, is making it impossible for Nigeria to function as a viable state. And that is a recognition that we must, at this very point in time, be able to address as educated people. Not that I hate Nigeria. I hate the name. I despise it with a passion. If you allow me, I wouldn't exist tomorrow morning. Anybody who answers or addresses him or herself as a Nigerian is a product of neocolonialism, not something that I am prepared to accept, because Nigeria never existed until Flora Shaw gave had that name, Nigeria. Before that, you had Oduduwa. Before that, you had Biafra. Before that, you had Kanem-Borno Empire and all these wonderful and weird civilizations. Now, a white man cannot come from Europe and then create an identity for me. Only God in heaven can do that. And I can give an identity to my dog. The only thing you can name are your children and your pets. They are not our fathers. They are Caucasians. We are black Africans. They have no right being in Africa and giving us names, and that I will never ever accept.
Military and security experts have said it is impossible for any country to fight two civil wars without monumental repercussions. Have you considered this, and what lessons did you learn from the last Nigerian civil war?
The lessons that I will learn from the last war, if I can beginning by addressing your last question, is that we should not have given up. Even though we were overawed as a result of a global conspiracy of unprecedented proportions, Biafra-Nigeria war was the Third World War. Because in that war, if you leave Nigeria and Biafra alone, Biafra would defeat Nigeria anytime, any day. Pound for pound, Biafra would defeat Nigeria anytime, any day. And I make bold to say this. But Britain got involved. They imposed a no-fly zone over Biafra land. They imposed air, land, and sea blockade to stop us from getting food and arms. But they went behind the back of the world to negotiate with Russia to supply arms to go on. They even brought in Egyptian pilots to fly their planes for them. Nigeria has never won any war in its history. Ordinary Boko Haram, they are begging Niger, they are begging Chad, they are begging Cameroon to help them. They've never won any war. The only thing they specialize in doing is killing civilians, as they did at Lekki Toll Gate. That's what they can do. Nigeria has never fought any war. An army is meant to go out to win territories for the country that it claims is coming from. The same way that Lugard led an expeditionary force to come to create Nigeria for the crown in Britain. Nigerian soldiers have not done that before. Anywhere they go, they're humiliated and they come back. So I wouldn't actually see, I wouldn't describe what's transpired between 67 to 70 as a Biafra-Nigeria war. Is Biafra versus the whole world. The United States was ambivalent. They never actually, should I say, participated as they should. Britain was there running the whole show. They destroyed Aburi Accord, destroyed the agreement reached between Ojukwu and Gowon. They came back and they instigated a war. That was all they did. There was not, I wouldn't see it as a war. And I want to let Nigeria understand this. There is that tendency, that what I call the Fulani Janja Buddhism, there is that tendency to intimidate, that tendency to terrorize, that tendency to subdue, overawe, and then conquer people. It is not going to happen in our time. They will try, but they will fail. The more they focus their attention in the East, the more the terrorists that they themselves bred in the North will overrun them there. So I am not in any way, shape, or form either phased or overawed. They will come again because it's in their nature, and this time around, they'll be roundly defeated.
Well, I think with due respect to our men and women of armed forces, I believe they are well rated. I visited them in Liberia. I visited them in Sierra Leone. In Liberia, we were controlling 10 out of 15 counties. In Sierra Leone, in fact, we actually lost one of our brigadiers, and the Sierra Leoneans are eternally grateful to us, because but for the support from Nigeria, both countries, I don't know what would have happened to them. In fact, at the time, Professor Adeniji was the head of UNANSIL in Sierra Leone. I think it would be unfair to describe our military as weak. It is possible, yes, that they got support from somewhere else. Of course, there are allies. That's why you had NATO. In fact, it's one of the reasons a lot of people are angry with America under Trump, that he has virtually collapsed the relationship, military ties to other countries. So I'll leave it at that. But then I want to go to the next question. The Igbos are obviously marginalized in the political configuration of Nigeria, but they have done extremely well globally in business, in sciences, in commerce, and so on. Won't they risk a lot of these spectacular achievements if you decide to go the way you want to go?
I should have thought that your question should be along the line of, had those people been in Nigeria, don't you think that Nigeria would be a better place? For instance, but it's never happened and will never happen for the following reasons. Resentment, envy, and the need for the Fulani Janjaweed Caliphate to dumb down the standard of excellence so that everybody can become an Alimajiri. That's exactly what I have done. I am not shocked nor surprised that we are recording not just, you know, Igbo people or Biafrans, but Yorubas are doing the same thing as well all over the place. Is there? What I then want to ask people is this.
Why is it that we cannot wake up one morning and hear that there is one Fulani mathematician in Florida doing very well, maybe working for NASA? Why is it that we have not woken up one morning to hear there is one Fulani man or woman voted in as a mayor or as an, a parliamentarian somewhere in Europe? It will never ever happen, because that is not their orientation. That is not how they were brought up to see society. The recognition of people's skills and talent is a prerequisite for the driving of any progressive society. That hasn't happened in Nigeria, because if you're not from the north, may God help you. Why is Nigeria suffering today? Nigeria is suffering because of successive regimes of mediocrity and sub-standardization, for the simple reason that people do things based on ethnicity. People want to protect their tribe. Even if they're performing very badly, they want their tribe to become preeminent. And in the process, those men and women who are skilled, who are well-read, who are well-learned, they get forgotten. And then, of course, they travel abroad, and you can see their excellence come to the fore. And that's exactly what has been happening. What we are saying is that once we have Biafra, they will all come back home. And Biafra will quite rightly become the light of Africa and black people all over the world. Because without Biafra, black Africa will keep floundering, and there can never be any progress.
I'm sure you know that politics is a game of number. And it has been theorized that the domination you complain about of the, what you call the Fulani hegemony, has been made possible because of the lack of unity amongst the peoples of North Central, Southeast, South South, and Southwest. And that if they unite, they will be able to end the perpetual dominance of the so-called Northern oligarchy. Do you agree?
100%. And that was why some of us threw our weight behind our children. Some people will say, refer to me as a youth, but I'm not. I'm a very old man. I may look young, but I'm a very old man. Now, the reason why we supported our young people was because for the first time in living memory, we managed to bridge that divide, to bring everybody closer around an issue that is of importance and concern to all these people. Were you not surprised when, following what transpired on the 20th of this very month, the same people that have failed and will continue to fail, the same leadership structure, or should I say the same cozy boys club that they formed, if your father is passing on, he will hand you over to the next buffoon to groom you in this politics of mediocrity that you find in Nigeria. Were you not surprised and shocked that the same people managed, or should I say succeeded, in introducing the tribal and ethnic dimension into what we are doing? Those of us in the South, I am proud of the understanding that those of us in the East have with our Yoruba brothers in the West, and of course, as time goes on, also Middle Belt. There is now a recognition that we are our own worst enemies. In Katsina State, there are other tribes other than Hausa and Fulani. In Katsina, in Bauchi, the same thing. All across the north, it is not a homogeneous society. The only thing that binds them together is just their language. Underneath, if you scratch the surface, you will begin to see a lot of, they have more ethnic groups in the north than you have in the south. Many more in the north than you have in the south. But over the years, the Fulani oligarchy have managed to moderate their differences. And despite what is going on underneath, they have always succeeded in presenting this united front for the North. Anytime we try that in the South, they bring in people referred to as professional gossipers. They bring in people who will always do their best to divide us. Because the North understands. Any day the Igbo and the Yoruba put their differences behind them, get their acts together, for goodness sake, Nigeria will be a better place. Everybody knows that very well. So in order not to allow that to happen, they now appoint, or should I say, rig our governors into office. They go to Ohanaeze, they bribe a few people to go to Afani Fere, they identify one or two people to, should I say, to groom, to do their dirty jobs for them. And what is that dirty job? You saw it in full view and in full display on the 20th. People that claim they went to school, people that claim they are senior advocates, people that claim they're enlightened, were the ones that introduced the tribal and ethnic dimension into that very successful protest. And you can see where we are today. They are rejoicing in the North. They're having fun in the North. That thing they have always done, once again, they have done it. But of course, they cannot break us. This time around, we will just want to let them understand this. The unity between the Igbos and the Yorubas is deeper than End SARS protest. It is far more fundamental than they can even imagine.
Now, is Biafra your only option, or you are willing to work with other so-called oppressed peoples to form a union like it is in the United Arab Emirates?
Everything depends on what the people want. I am a Democrat. I am a Republican by genetic disposition. Anything the people want is what they're going to get. My dream and my mission is Biafra. Let's say during a referendum, people decide we want to be, yes, Biafra is good. We can answer Biafra within a union that comprises of Middle Belt, of Oduduwa and Biafra with a new name. Who am I to say no? I'm a Democrat. Whatever the majority decides is what I'm going to do. But as for us, we are pursuing Biafra. And I will also help the Oduduwa people to pursue the Oduduwa Republic. I will help the Middle Belt to do the same. But one thing is paramount. Should our people decide at a referendum or place beside to say, we want to maintain a semblance of union with Oduduwa and the Middle Belt, who am I to say no? I am a Democrat and I will go with it. But my primary concern now is the restoration of Biafra.
An audio surfaced recently, I think about 2 weeks ago. It was sent to me by a family member, in which your voice, we heard your voice, directing your operatives to hit certain targets in Lagos. What led to this in a state that has really embraced the people of Southeast and South extractions? If that was your voice, do you regret the action, and are you willing to apologize for it?
It is my voice, but what I said was caught and joined together to suit the very message or narrative that our detractors were, should I say, determined to peddle. If you listen to the whole broadcast that I made, you will find out that very audio that those people, those charlatans put out there in the public domain is not exactly what I intended. But I have said this before and allow me to repeat. If by making the pronouncement that I made on that very day that I was misunderstood, or that the true intentions of what I was wishing or willing to convey was somehow misconstrued, then I apologize for it. Because I believe that it is very, very important that we understand this. I wouldn't want to do anything, either knowingly or unknowingly, to inflame passions in the West. I wouldn't wish to do anything that would cause my Yoruba brothers and sisters alike to think, should I say, to become jittery about what our true intentions are. You made reference to your operatives. I was addressing Nigerian youths right across Nigeria, not just in Lagos. And given the heat of the moment, people were being massacred. I'm not sure that most of those commentators and apologists for Asorok have had their homes invaded before. When Fela speaks, you can hear the way that Fela speaks all the time. about Nigeria Army and Nigeria Police. Why? Because Fela was a witness when his house was invaded and the mother died as a result of it. Did something happen to me? As a result of Nigeria military invasion of my house, my father is dead and my mother is dead as well. So when people like us with a first-hand experience of the brutality of a very primitive security architecture in a country as backward as Nigeria, you can then begin to appreciate where we're coming from. If I spoke out of turn, if people who listened to what I said misunderstood the true intentions behind the words that I uttered that night, then I do unreservedly apologize, because nobody can divide the Yorubas and the Igbos anymore. It's not going to happen. They will try, but they will not succeed. That I can assure them. What is of concern to us is that those responsible for the slaughter of those people are held responsible. The same way I hasten to add that those who are responsible for the murder that we can order today going on in Obigo will be held accountable. They will and must be held accountable. I do apologize if I offended anyone, but no offense was intended in the first place. I gave an order to Nigerian youths right across the board to do what they did because the Nigerian state is evil. They believe in killing their own children. They believe in suppressing free speech. They believe in breaking up peaceful assembly with the use of force. That type of nonsense must come to an end, and they must be taught a lesson, and that was exactly what we did.
Okay, let me confess that it was actually that audio that led me to looking for you. You see, I believe that journalists must help their nation to understand some certain people and personalities like yourself. And I want to say at this stage that I'm sending my special thanks to two people. One of them, I can mention publicly, the other doesn't. Would not want me to mention him. And the first is Femi Fanikaode, my very dear friend and brother. I contacted him because I knew there is a special bond between the two of you. And he contacted someone else who contacted you. And I want to say thank you to both of them so they know themselves. What is the relationship between you and Femi that every time I see that you are in the same direction?
He is very brave. He is urbane. He is polished and very erudite. He is a scholar and a conscientious one at that. You know, in Nigeria, you have scholars, people who just study for the sake of it, people who just read for the sake of it. He practicalizes what he understands to be humanity. And that is why I love him, I respect him, and I call him a brother. He epitomizes what any intellectual should aspire to be. You intellectualize, that is very true or very good, and then you must have a human side to yourself. He is de-tribalized, as you well know, and I'm sure that in time to come, he will have a very great role to play, if not in Oduduwa, but also in Biafra. If Biafra were to come tomorrow, I would take him. And I'm sure that he will have a lot to contribute in making Biafra a better place for everybody to be in. So I have not only love for him, but also have regard for him.
Now, I'm sure you are aware that there are efforts to start a movement that will bring the Yorubas and the Igbos together and closer. Are you willing to play a major role in that union?
Yes, we are doing ours on the ground. You saw the protest on the 1st of October right across the world, Yoruba One Voice and IPOB. So we are doing ours. That was why I categorically stated, and without any equivocation, that the bond between the Yorubas and the Igbos can no longer be broken by anybody. They will thrive, but they will fail. It can't be broken anymore. So I am more than willing and able to serve in whatever capacity that is required of me to make sure that these two great nations pilot the affairs of Black people in Africa going forward. Because without them, Africa is doomed, more or less.
Now, I will plead with you to take the next question very softly. Because as a Christian, I believe my faith teaches me to render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's. So which means I respect constituted authority. My question is about your best friend, our president and commander. Now, you propounded this theory of a cloned man, and that our current president is a Sudanese man called Jibril. Do you agree that your information might have been wrong, and you are also willing to apologize to him for that error? Anybody can make a mistake.
No, not at all. Buhari is dead and buried in a shallow grave in Saudi Arabia. Aisha Buhari was there. She came back from what they called a lesser Hajj. She was wearing black. She was mourning. If you look at the pictures that were circulated at that point in time, you will see the smug, or should I say, the forlorn faces of northern governors. A minute silence was held at the AU for a late Buhari. Even Her Britannic Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, also penned a condolence message to the people of Nigeria before the cabal took over and asked her to rescind it, which she did. Buhari is dead, and I'm prepared to stake Biafra on it. If you, Dele Momodu, can go and prove to me, I'm not asking you to do anything too complex. If you can go and ask this man you call Buhari, whoever it is in Asorok, to come outside, don't do very much, address a panel of Nigerian youths, maybe 20 of them, and speak Buhari's mother tongue, which is Fulfude. I will give up Biafra, I will apologize to him, and I will submit myself to any authority on this earth to do with me as they please. There is no Buhari. Jibril was there. Jibril followed Abba Kyari to Cuba and ran away from there and never came back. The man you have now in Asorok is from Niger Republic. His name is Yusuf Abubakar Muhammad. That's his name. Yusuf Abubakar Muhammad. Even Shekau knows who he is personally and was mentioning his name as well. It is not Buhari. The old Buhari that you and I know, the country cannot be burning and he will restrict himself to only 12 minutes of edited broadcast. Impossible. Impossible. Anybody that knows Buhari, even if he's dying, he must speak, because he fought in his own understanding to keep Nigeria one. Anything that impacts or threatens the territory, cohesion and integrity of Nigeria, the old Buhari, in fact, he'll be in Lagos. The old Buhari will be in Lagos, I'm telling you. But this little, have you not seen him with his fresh hands? Hands of a 35-year-old. He cannot wear this. He cannot wear this. Because if he wears this, his ear will bend. Because it's rubber. Silicone. We know about AI technology. It's deep fake. Please Google it. You're a media man. You must know this. I can replicate this very interview with your face showing us having this conversation. But it is not you. You also saw that some eagle-eyed investigators managed to discover that there was actually a microphone, that a loudspeaker on the table. It's everything that they claimed that Buhari was saying was coming from a loudspeaker. From a loudspeaker. Very, very sad indeed. These are the things that the world must understand and come to terms with. That the person you are calling Buhari is not Buhari, and I can stake my life on it. If he comes out tomorrow and takes, or should I say, address any press interview live without Garo Bashir, who bring this, telling people to court. If he can come out tomorrow, a panel of journalists will, not journalists, because some of them are corrupt, youths will address him. There and then you will know that Buhari is no more. There is no Buhari. No country. How can you have a country you claim you're proud of? And that country is run by 10-minute video recorded every 4 months. What sort of country is that? Every 4 months you issue a pre-recorded video to address 200 million people. What an insult. What an insult. In a time of crisis, there is COVID-19. People are agitating. They're very restive. The only thing you can do is 10 minutes video. Laughable and absolutely absurd. And no sensible person should be able to tolerate it. Buhari is dead. And I stake my life on it.
Please don't stake your life on it, because I am very, very convinced that he is alive. I have been meeting Buhari since 2010. Okay? And the last time I met him was 2 years ago inside Aso Rock with a former president of Africa. I met him, we interacted, he cracked jokes with me, he even said, Dele, it seems you've added weight. I am telling you that I am not foolish not to know the person I've been seeing for 10 years. I've worked closely with him on his campaign. And yes, you could have your theory. Why you think? You see, my own theory is different. Because he was very sick, a lot of people thought that he would die. And God restored his life. And I think that is why you think he is dead. I am personally convinced that he's alive. I believe that a man like President Olusegun Obasanjo will not go and hold any meeting with a cloned president of Nigeria. If I can't vouch for any other person, I know that Obasanjo will never agree. He will talk.
There is a saying where I come from, Dele. Ahunje could be a robber. If you see something that is greater than your farm, you sell your barn where your harvest of yam is, where you store your yam, because that is the greatest thing that any Igbo man has in the olden days. If you see something that is greater than your farm, you sell your barn. And you could be a robber. They do not want to expose that the father Buhari is dead, because everybody depends on the oil and gas coming from Biafra land. Without oil and gas, Nigeria will be worse than a banana republic. There will be nothing happening there. Nigeria runs what is called a rentier economy. You sell oil and gas to import everything you need, including toothpick, including Indomie and pasta. So what is called the doctrine of stabilization. If you come out and you announce that Buhari is dead, there will be pandemonium everywhere. In fact, the U.S. government feels that if they allow a precipitous collapse of Nigeria, it may impact the wider region. That is what the Africa desk at the State Department has been doing for very many years. So if you expose the fact that Buhari is dead, it will cause pandemonium and there will be regional destabilization. And you will have a whole load more of foreign terrorist groups to contend with. Now you have 7. Many more will come up. They do not want to turn northern Nigeria into another Yemen, Afghanistan, or Syria, or Somalia, for that matter. That is the only reason why they're keeping quiet. And everybody's hoping that he will make it to 2023 so that Aisha can go with the boyfriend and relax, because Buhari is dead. Absolutely dead and confirmed. Look at the hands of your, I can become a trained, you ever seen that little boy they call Tagwe? That used to mimic Buhari, speak the way that Buhari does, crack Buhari jokes. That little boy is an Igbo boy. They've not given him a Fulani girl to marry. You know that little boy called Tagwe, he's a comedian. He mimics Buhari. These things happen. People can mimic Obama. People can mimic whoever they want to mimic. There are expert actors who can do all of these things. But let me make this very clear to you. It's a very simple thing. I'm not asking for a DNA test anymore. If Buhari can hold a meeting, the man you call Buhari, with Nigerian youths to ask him questions and speak his mother tongue Fufude, then I will give up. But I can assure you categorically that you are one of those that they have deceived, but they cannot deceive us. It was a well-choreographed, well-planned, and executed with military precision. They knew what they were doing because Britain is in charge. Britain is in charge. The same way they took charge of the NSAS protest. You were there, you were watching. When British High Commissioner went to Lagos, did not see the Lagos State Governor, Petsor Tinubu, not up to 48 hours, the army came and started shooting. And now, as they say, the rest is history. The people controlling you are those that created you. The people that made you a Nigerian are those now in charge of your lives. You are not in charge of Nigeria. They are, and are the ones running the show. And maybe next week, you get another 10 minutes video recorded. The old Buhari couldn't have done that. Ask Obasanjo, how many times did you allow them to broadcast a recorded speech in a time of national crisis? How many times, Obasanjo will tell you none. Jonathan, the same thing. Only this thing that they put up there. Now, I will ask you to put on your face mask. Put it on. Put on your face mask. Let us see. Do you have one with you?
Yeah.
Ask them to bring it for you. Put it on. Your ear will not bend. Your ear can never bend. It's impossible because you're a human being. You have cartilage in your ear. But if this ear is made of silicone, as the one that Aisha's boyfriend is wearing, once you put on mask, your ear will bend. Simple. And that is why we have common sense and brain. Keep asking yourself. They took a picture with Jonathan, with everybody, with Yemi Osinbajo. None of them had their ears bent. Only Buhari's ears were bent. Others were wearing the same mask, but only Buhari's ear was bent, meaning that it's made out of rubber. Silicon. He's the person that's not Buhari and can never ever be. Please go ahead.
Okay. So do you have a map for Biafra where will it start from and where will it end?
First of all, do you know that if I ask you now, Dele, how many states do you have Igbo people in Nigeria? How many states would you tell me? It's a simple question. You're a journalist.
I would say everywhere.
No. I mean, where they are indigenous to. Where they come from. There could be Igbo people in Lagos and not from Lagos. They're Igbo people. If I ask you right now, how many states in Nigeria do you think that Igbo people are indigenous to? How many would you say? 5? Southeast states? After all, that is the Igbo territory. Is that what you would say?
Yes.
I have a surprise for you. It is 13. Igbo people are indigenous to 13 states of Nigeria. 13. As I told you, those who created Nigeria are in charge of Nigeria. And in order to weaken, to diminish, to render irrelevant every aspiration of an Igbo man, Britain decided to advise the Janjaweed Caliphate to keep redrawing the map until we now have only 5 states. Igbo people are in 13 states. And now let me answer your question. The map of Biafra starts from wherever women tie two-piece wrapper and ends where they stop tying two-piece wrapper. In other words, Biafra land starts from Kogi in the north, in Igala land, Idoma, Igede, all the way to Ikodomikodo, Idu land, in Udo, and going down to Bakassi, after Cross River State, and to Bonny, and to Opobo in the south. All these are Biafran territories, because if you go there, all the women that you...
The 13 states. I want the 13 states, please.
You want me to name for you the 13 states that make up?
Yes, please.
Kogi, are there Igbo people in Kogi? I'm sure the answer is yes.
Yes.
Indigenous. Are there Igbo people in Edo State? Yes. We agree. In Edo State, there are Igbo people. I'm not talking about Ubiaja, which is Ishan. We'll come to that later. I'm even talking about a place called Igbo Akere. Are there Igbo people in Delta State? Yes. Are there Igbo people in Benue? In Benue State, I'm asking you, is Z community? Is in Benue State. They speak Igbo. The largest market you have in Benue belong to the Igbo communities in Benue State. Are there Igbo people in Cross River? Yes. So, but Igbo people are in Cross River. Are Igbo people in Akwa Ibom? Yes, Itu is in Akwa Ibom. There are Igbo people there. Are there Igbo people in River State? Are there Igbo people there? Of course there are. 90% of River State is Igbo. Are there Igbo people in Bayelsa? And you'll be shocked. Y-E-S is the answer. There are Igbo-speaking people inside Bayelsa itself till tomorrow morning. The same way you have Igbo people in Ondo. Are there Igbo people in all the five? I've counted for you the six states that make up the so-called South-South. Imo, Abia, Anambra, Ebonyi.
Yeah, you've mentioned nine now. Nine states. 1, 2, 3. Kogi, Edo, Benue, Cross River, Akwa Ibom, Rivers, Bayelsa, Ondo.
Have you added? No, not in Ondo. We're not in Ondo. Igbo is not in Ondo. What is in Ondo is Ijo. Ijo is in Ondo, not Igbo. But okay. Ijo is Biafra. And we'll get to that later. And then you add the five southeastern states. You have Imo, you have Anambra, you have Enugu, you have Ebonyi, you have Abia. Add all of them together.
Imo, Anambra, Ebonyi, Abia,
Enugu.
Enugu. 1, 2.
Add it to the other six.
Okay.
Five southeastern states.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I think one is missing somewhere.
One cannot be six states of the South-South, five states of the Southeast, then Kogi and Benue, and then you get 13. In all these places, you have, I'm not telling you about where they are trading, where they are doing business. People from there are Igbo. They are indigenous.
And you think Kogi would agree to go with Biafra?
No, it's about a referendum. What we're asking for is that part of Kogi where women tie two-piece wrapper. That's all. Your mother will tell you where you come from. If you look at your mother when she dresses up to go to church or to go to a function and she's tying two-piece wrapper, one on top of the other, then you know you're a Biafran. And that's what they do in Kogi, in Enugu State, in Benue State, in Cross River State, all the way down. You can go all the way down to Edo State. It is there till tomorrow morning.
Don't you think you are likely to hit the brick wall if you try to go expansionist, if I could put it that way?
I am an Igbo man. With all due respect, my dear brother, the Yorubas may be comfortable leaving Yoruba people in Togo and the Benin Republic and calling somebody from Sokoto State their brother. I don't intend to do that. Wherever you have Igbo people, they must be together as one. We are not leaving anybody behind. We cannot leave anybody behind. It was the Fulani Janjaweed and the British that caused this problem. You cannot come to my land. You take an Igbo community, you give them to Benue, you give them to Kogi, and you say they're from the north. Ohanaeze may tolerate it. I will not tolerate it. I can't tolerate it. I am not going to leave one single Igbo community anywhere. They must be part of Biafra. They must be part of Biafra.
What happens? Let's say the other people that you are fighting get provoked and they decide to call your bluff and say, okay, Igbo people in Kaduna, in Katsina, in Sokoto to thy tent, O Israel. How will that fit into your plan?
Quite frankly,
before you answer, let me do it as a double warning. And what if the Igbos in those places say they are not interested in joining you?
Hallelujah. We say good riddance. Everything we are doing is based on the consent of the people. There must be a referendum. Or should I say referendum, which is the plural, right across the board. We are going to ask people ethnicity by ethnicity where they wish to belong. If they say we want to be part of the Janjaweed North, where once in a while you lose your daughter, your wife could be raped, oh, well and good. We let them go. I am a Democrat. I'm not going to force anybody to do anything. And Biafra must come via a referendum. People must agree to it. We are not forcing anyone to do anything. Everything we are saying and doing is geared towards one outcome, a referendum. If they agree, fine. If they don't agree.
So who is going to organize this referendum that you've been talking about?
The United Nations will have to organize it at the right time. They will.
If it is not organized, what is your plan B?
We continue with civil unrest and civil disobedience, boycott of elections. As one of our great heroes said, we will boycott all boycottables until we get what we want. The British never wanted to leave Africa, but they did. Russia never wanted the Soviet Union to break up, but it did. Serbia never wanted Yugoslavia to break up, but it did. Sudan never wanted South Sudan. They never wanted South Sudan to be free. They're free today. Ethiopia never wanted, Eritrea to be free, but today Eritrea is free. So that tells you all you need to know. It is not in their hands because you know what? Power belongs to the people. Anything we want is what we're going to get.
Once again, I want to ask this. Do you think this dream is realizable without a war? And are you prepared to fight another war?
This dream can be realized without a war. And let me put it this way. As soon as the people, the various ethnic groups in Nigeria realize what Nigeria means to each and every ethnic group, they will subscribe to our position. So it is realizable without a war. Before the white man came, let me ask you this, because it's an interview, which means you can ask me questions and I can ask you. Before the white man came, was there any Nigeria? Before the white man came, did Nigeria exist? It's a simple question that I'm asking you. Dele, did Nigeria exist before?
It didn't, no.
It didn't exist. Then why are African people, black people, dying over something that they did not create? Did any Yoruba man create Nigeria? The answer is no. No Igbo man created Nigeria. No Hausa man did. No Fulani man did. No Kanuri man did. No Jukun man did. When you come to Nigeria, it's always a debate about it is our turn. It is our turn. It is our turn to rule. Now, there are over 250 main ethnic groups in Nigeria. If you keep rotating the presidency every 8 years to each and every ethnic group, times 8 by 250, how many years are you going to get? So some people will die many times over. They will reincarnate many times over. The presidency hasn't come to them. Nigeria is a joke and an absolute mess. It was not created by black people. Therefore, it cannot be sustained by black people. I want to see an Africa where a Yoruba nation, a Yoruba mega nation, extends from Togo all the way to Edo State. That's what I want. Because that is authentic Africa. I don't know why Africans are so beholden to something that is alien to them. Are you a white man? The Luger that created Nigeria is a white man. What are you doing as an African defending something that a white man created out of, or should I say, a racist intent? Nigeria was an ordinary company, Royal Niger Company, an ordinary business venture that the British converted into a nation. And Africans are killing themselves, trying to maintain something that a white man created. Sometimes I wonder what type of God made African people. I don't understand it. And that is why you have this neocolonialism. That is why the British High Commissioner had to go to Tinubu to ask him, how do you end this protest? Because if this protest continues, you're jeopardizing our oil. Nnamdi Kanu can use it as an advantage to go and get Biafra. They asked the army to go in and kill people. You people are being ruled by your colonial masters. Your faith is not in your hand. You're in a country that is 60 years old, so to speak. There is no electricity. If I am a Nigerian, I can't come out and say I'm a Nigerian. I'll be ashamed of myself. For 60 years, you have no electricity. For 60 years, no good roads. For 60 years, no good schools. For 60 years, your politicians are traveling abroad for medical treatment. I ask you, what is there to be proud of about Nigeria? Name one thing you can be proud of. Name one thing. It's a question I'm asking you, Dele. Tell me one thing you can be proud of in Nigeria.
Nigerians are amongst the brightest people in the world, including the Igbo people, of which you are one. You're a very brilliant man. That is Nigeria in your DNA.
I was born a Biafran, not a Nigerian. Nigeria is a historical mistake.
Was there a birth certificate at that time that wrote Biafra on it?
Of course, yes. You want me to show you? I'll show it to you. I can email it to you. It's not here with me right now. I can email it to you. My person is with Biafra.
I don't mind.
I will email it to you. So you see, what I'm asking is, if Nigeria never existed until the white man came, why are you, as a black African man, defending it? What's a white man created? Why? When you have Yorubas in Benin Republic, Yoruba is in Togo, they speak your language, they eat your food, they dress the same way you do, you have the same culture, the same value system, the same orientation, and I'm asking you, and the white man came from Europe and said, oh, you are Yoruba from Togo, you speak French. You're Yoruba from Benin Republic, you're going to speak French. But you, Dele, you're Yoruba from Nigeria, you speak English. Are people not put off by that? That level of dehumanization, that level of subjugation. You see, the one thing that shocks me about Africa and their class of intellectuals is the fact that they are willing to swallow hook, line, and sinker anything the colonial master gives to them. And I've asked you this very question. Can you go to Europe and create a country as a black man? The answer is no. Then why must you accept what a white man is doing in Africa? Do you see why we are poor and very backwards? Do you see why Nigeria can never have 24 hours of electricity? Never, ever, ever, ever. Because the foundation is faulty. The orientation of Fulani Janja, people were protesting SARS killings in the South. Fulani people in the North were busy having fun and laughing and smiling. And you want to be in the same country with them. Your value system, your reasoning, your understanding, your orientation can never, ever be the same. Never be the same. Why did Britain leave the EU? Dele, I'm asking you, are they not Christians? Are they not Democrats? Don't they believe in free trade and voting people in and voting them out? But then, why did Britain leave the EU? Why? The same Britain that left the EU is asking me not to leave Nigeria. Nigeria that is only 100 years old. Your grandfather was not a Nigerian. Was not. So why must you throw away the history of your family, the rich history of Yoruba people? Because a white man called the place Nigeria. Why must you do that? Why? Can I go to England and name them and name them Albania and say all your history is now gone? We are doing our ancestors a disservice. And let me tell you why Black Africa cannot go forward. Some people accepted this nonsensical balkanization of Africa with their useless flag independence. And your ancestors are in the grave. Your ancestors that existed before the white man was born, they're in the grave. You jettison their history and their identity. You banish it. You denigrate it. You insult them by accepting this garbage called Nigeria. And you want them to be happy with you. That is why no black African country can see development. You see South Africa. When whites were running South Africa, everything was good. Now blacks took over. Look at what is happening. Because even the land of Africa itself is angry with us. We went to school for a reason. The reason why you go to school is to question certain things. And the question is this. Why is it that you, as an African, you're willing to kill, to die for something a white man created when they cannot do the same thing for you? You see how they are not equal to us. You see why they are always better than us. And nobody can tell me with any ounce of conviction or justification the reason why Yoruba people should be in Togo, in Benin, and in Nigeria. Why can't they be in one country the same way that the English people are in one country in England? Or should I say in the UK? These are the things that we must ask ourselves.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Mazi Namkano. I mean, you are very passionate about your beliefs. Nobody can take that away from you. So now we get to the stage where I already jotted down some questions from members of the public. The first is that you hold a dual nationality. So they are saying you have a choice, you have an option. What about those who have nowhere to go?
The reason why you are interviewing me today is because I got lucky. My parents didn't get lucky. People who were in my house did not get lucky that very day. They died. My dog also died. Jack, they killed my dog. Now, listen very carefully. People don't understand. You see, there is a level of flippancy in Africa, and should I say, we don't interrogate any concept or phenomenon with a great degree of sincerity. Why do I have a Nigerian passport? The same way that Awolowo, Chief Obafemi Awolowo, held onto a British travel document. Did that stop Awolowo from fighting for Nigeria to be independent? I'm asking you a simple question. Did that stop him? Awolowo went to Glasgow to study.
He, a British document.
Exactly. He traveled abroad. Awolowo traveled abroad to study. He read economics in Scotland. And he came back. Probably even on British scholarship. The fact that Awolowo was availed of free education in England and traveled to England by ship in those days with British papers, did it stop Chief Awolowo from fighting for independence of his people?
And I must say, he was a lawyer.
Thank you. Sorry, I do apologize. He was a lawyer as well. But he also read economics. Do you know he read economics as well? He also read, he's a lawyer. I agree. Now, I'll ask that question again so you answer, so that the whole world can hear. The fact that Awolowo went to England and studied, or let me say Britain and studied, United Kingdom, came back, became a lawyer and an economist. Did that stop Chief Awolowo from campaigning for independence from Britain? I don't know if you can hear me. Can you hear me?
Hearing you, yeah. I understand your logic, yeah.
Now, the same thing with Dr. Nnamdi Azikiwe. He traveled to the US. He studied. He traveled to the US with British papers. As somebody traveling from a British colony, he went to the US and he read, and he came back. And a Yoruba man, incidentally, let me tell you why they don't want Yorubas and the Igbos to be. A Yoruba man, identified the talent in Nnamdi Azikiwe and appointed him the secretary of NCNC. That Yoruba man is Herbert Macaulay, a Yoruba man. And Zeke fought with the likes of Awolowo until Nigeria became free. Why didn't they say, you know, in those days they were very intelligent. Nobody said to Zeke, you went to England for free. You studied. You have their passport. Now you're fighting and saying they should go. Because in those days, our fathers, they had brain. I'm sorry to say, this generation, I don't know what's wrong with them. It's a social media indomie generation. And I hope that after this evening, they will become, more enlightened as to the issues. I no longer hold dual nationality. I used to have dual nationality for convenience sake, just to travel out of Nigeria, not for anything. And my hatred for Nigeria didn't start today. I've always hated Nigeria. It's a very useless place. Only a fool can say, I am a proud Nigerian. There's nothing to be proud of. Absolutely nothing. You have nothing. Individually, you're brilliant. The Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala's of this world, our brother who is at Africa Development Bank, very smart and very brainy, yes, as an individual, but collectively as a group, the most useless 200 million people in the whole world. Nothing is coming out of nothing. Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. So how can I be a proud Nigerian? Ordinary light you don't have. No, simple light you don't have. How can I be a proud Nigerian? Thank you very much.
Now, your governors have virtually rejected Biafra. Those are the most senior representatives of the people. So this person is asking, how do you want to deal with that situation?
How many governors do we have per state?
One governor per state, yes. But they
control, in a democracy,
they control no. Yes.
How many, during election, how many times does the governor vote?
Once.
Okay. So the people will decide, not a governor. We are not Fulani Janjaweed. We don't have feudal lords in our land. We are Democrats or Republicans. You have only one vote. Only one vote. One governor, one vote. People may dissent, they're entitled to their opinion. One governor, one vote during the place beside or referendum. And there is nothing they can do about it. The majority says they want Biafra. So the views of a governor, of course, may be taken into consideration, but it doesn't count because they are in the minority. We are not Fulani people.
Someone has asked, how are you funded?
We are the largest movement on the face of this very planet Earth. IPOB, Indigenous People of Biafra, we're all over the world. And our people are very, very generous. They fund us. No politician, no millionaire, no billionaire, nobody. Ordinary people in the diaspora and people at home. They fund this well-oiled machine all over the world. That is why we are formidable. We owe it to them. We don't have any godfathers. That is why I speak the way I do. If there's anybody who can say they are funding us, come out and say it. Nobody does. Ordinary people do. Because everybody wants freedom.
Someone is asking, if you say you're asking for a referendum, how come you sometimes apply force, the use of force and coercion?
That is the only thing the Fulani Janjaweed would understand. Nigeria is a rogue creation. Nigeria is where vandals and bandits abound in political office. Nigeria is not a civilized society and can never ever be. You saw the way they were behaving. You give rice to a governor to give to people, the governor will steal it and keep it. Palliate it that he did not buy. The only language they understand is by breaking into those warehouses and taking what belongs to you. The criminals and the hoodlums here are the governors, not the people who are hungry. I don't know why in Africa we always want to turn the narrative upside down. So you're telling me that Fulani can come to my place and rape my mother, abduct my sister, and I'll be clapping and praying and doing hallelujah and doing prayer and fasting. Namdekam is not like that. We hunt them down, we pursue them, we catch them, and we deal with them. As simple as that. If people can tolerate that type of rubbish, we can't take it. Never, ever, ever. Never.
You said you're a Democrat.
Yes.
Does democracy allow the use of brute force?
Is Nigeria not a democracy? But they were in Lekki shooting people that their constitution says should not be shot. People praying and singing national anthem, we are shot. A constitutionally guaranteed right, the state of Nigeria violated it. They are the ones that brought violence, not us. As they say, those of them that make peaceful revolution impossible, they make violent revolution impossible. They make it possible, rather. Those are the words of John F. Kennedy, not mine. An American Democrat who, and people talk about democracy all the time. The modern Britain you have today was forged in the revolution led by Oliver Cromwell that toppled the monarchy of King Charles I. Today, England is doing very well. France talks about democracy. But their democracy was forged in the heat of a revolution that toppled the reign, I think, of King Louis XIV or the XV, I don't know, and Marie Antoinette. America, they hold you to account today if you're not democratic. America was forged in the battle of a revolution fought and led by George Washington. I don't know if we did all these things at all or not. I mean, I think Nigeria should employ me to write their curriculum for them so they can train sensible, reasonable people. People graduate from schools in Nigeria, they come out far more foolish than they actually went to school.
Someone has asked, are you not afraid for your life? And what happens?
I am dead already.
And at what happens if anything happens to you now? Do you have succession plans?
I am dead already. I was pouring some water to apologize. I am dead already. The only thing that can bring me back to life is Biafra. This life is meaningless without freedom, not just freedom. As I said before, I traveled to England to study for a reason and for a purpose. You cannot tell me that in England, they have gas piped all the way from the Scottish gas fields. There is 24 hours a day electricity. There is gas. If you're homeless or if you're unemployed, the government can give you what is called housing benefit. You can pay your rent and live in a decent home. They also give you money to feed as well. If I cannot do those things for my people, then my life is meaningless. So as I am right now, I'm already dead. I'm only waiting for Biafra to revive me and to resuscitate me. And I feel and I do pray that most other Africans should feel the way that I do. Because Africa is a failure because we fail to address the core and the key issues affecting our lives. We intend to change that. And by the grace of God Almighty in heaven, we shall be successful. My life doesn't matter anymore. What matters is Biafra. Everything else is irrelevant. And the zoo government, they know it. Everything is irrelevant. The only thing that matters to me, God is my witness, is Biafra. Nothing more. I'm not doing anything. I don't have a car. I have nothing. The only promise I said to God is, give me Biafra. That's all. I don't want anything else. What am I doing with money? What am I doing with cars? I don't need them. But Biafra I do need.
Now, someone says, if you disagree so vehemently with the English people for what you believe they've done in Nigeria, how come you accept their protection?
They are not protecting me. I'm sure if they have a chance to kill me, they will kill me. They're not protecting me. The only people that ever protected me was the state of Israel. Nobody else has ever protected me. Only Israel did. So if they have a chance to kill me, they will kill me. What protection is the person talking about? I said it before. Chief Obafemi Awolowo went to UK to study. Chief Obafemi Awolowo, because there's one good thing about the UK. If you study there, your eyes will open. You see how vocal and vociferous the protest in London was. Because we understand their game. We know the way they play it. And we feel sorry for our people that they cannot see what we have seen. But one day, who knows, their eyes may open. But as I keep saying, anything we do to ensure that freedom comes, not just to Biafra, to Duduwa, but to everybody, every ethnic group, I am all for it.
So could you tell me a bit about your project, the Radio Biafra?
Radio Biafra.
Of the Radio Freedom. Under Abacha. So I know a bit about pirate radios. So that's why I'm asking.
It's not a pirate radio. It's not pirate. Radio Biafra is registered in England. It's not a pirate radio. It is actually registered. It's not a pirate radio. That was the argument they were making before. And when they asked the UK to shut down Radio Biafra, UK told them we can't. It's a legitimate business. You know, it's a legitimate concern in the UK. So we can't shut it down. So it's not pirate. And we build our own transmitters. I don't know if you know that. The FM that you listen to in Lagos, if you're in Lagos right now, if you hear my voice tomorrow morning or the voice of any of the presenters tonight, we built ourselves. And I believe in encouraging ingenuity. Everything we have, we built ourselves. Because, of course, God is with us. And our mission and cause is noble. That is the history of Radio Biafra, and we keep expanding. And I do hope that before this month runs out, which is just a few days away, that Radio Biafra will be in Katsina broadcasting in Daura. Radio Biafra will be in Daura broadcasting. And they will complain, but they can't do anything about it because we are far ahead of them.
What are you doing in Daura when you said Buhari is not there? So what will you be doing in Daura?
No, they challenged us. Their MDC challenged us. They said they are going to buy equipment worth, is it 700 million to disrupt what we are doing? So in response, I said I will put a radio inside Daura and I'm going to do it. I will. There will be FM in Daura very soon. So educating the Janjaweed and Alamadi.
You cannot be jammed.
Who can jam it? Who is the person who can jam it? This is the technology from Biafra and you cannot do anything about it. That is why the Katuna line is running helter skelter to stop Biafra, because they know that once Biafra comes, maybe an African country cannot put a man on the moon. They don't want that because they know what we can do. And I'm saying it out in the open. They should try all they can to stop us. They cannot stop us. Eventually, we're going to win. Because this is God's project, not man's project. It's God that said, Biafra must come to put Kadam up with me, and not man.
On this note, I must say a big thank you to you for...
A wise man once told me...
...said about you. I may disagree with you on a number of things, but a lot of people didn't want this interview to take place. I told them, I hate censorship. I was a victim of censorship. Everybody must talk. If you don't talk, nobody will know why you do the things you do. And those who are disagree with you must still get to know more about you. I really appreciate agreeing to talk to me. Thank you so much, Mazi.
A wise man once told me. A wise man once told me.
Thank you and good night. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bueno.
By me, yeah. There is nothing they will do to me, yeah. Not today, not tomorrow, that will make me to abandon Biafra. It's impossible.